A quorum being present, I call the 2016 annual town meeting to order. The town clerk will read the return of service.
Pursuant to the written warrant, I summon and notify the inhabitants.
No, hang on, your mic's not on.
Yeah.
We need the mic on the table, please.
Pursuant to the within warrant, I summoned and notified the inhabitants of the town of Bedford as within my command by posting attested copies at the town hall and four other places in said town.
Thank you. Will the Bedford Minutemen please post the colors? We have a few special guests this evening. We have Boy Scouts from Troop 114, and we also have with us Peter Ashton, who is running for moderator in the town of Acton. He has come to see how Bedford does town meeting, and I told him that he's going to be a rookie watching a rookie, so we shall see whether he can learn anything or not. Town meeting is the annual business meeting of the town, and as such, proper decorum must be maintained at all times. Please refer to the guidelines for civil discourse on page 76 in the back of your warrant. We like to think that we are one of the most civil of all of the town meetings in Massachusetts. We've got a great reputation, and I hope we keep it that way. Town meeting rules from the bylaw of the town. No voter may speak without recognition by the moderator. Please stand at a microphone to be recognized, and you will see that we have numbered the microphones. It's not a quiz. You can pick any microphone you want. We've numbered them to make it easier for the people in the sound booth to know which person I'm recognizing. So I'm going to recognize you not by name, but by the number of the microphone that you're standing in front of. Speakers must give their name and address before commencing. No voter may speak in a debate more than twice on any article without specific permission from the moderator, except to correct a statement. Questions do not fall under this rule. Time limits imposed by the debate rules will be respected. Speakers must keep their debate within the scope of the motion on the floor. All questions must be directed through the moderator. Debate must be kept within the scope of the motion. All amendments must be given to the moderator and the town clerk in writing. Please, no clapping or booing. The local cable station is taping, and during the meetings only. There will be no taping during votes. Please turn off the ringer on your cell phone. And leave the hall if you need to talk on your phone. You should have received a colored card, just like this, when you checked in. We use these cards for counting votes and to obtain a secret ballot in the event that the meeting of the vote, that town meeting, so you've got to make sure you have a card. If you didn't get a card, please go back outside and get one, because your vote will not be counted without a card. And no, you don't tear it in half and share half with somebody else. Thank you. Town meeting procedures may be found on the last few pages of your warrant. We continue to use the guidelines for presentation that should help to improve visibility for all in the auditorium. Those guidelines are available on the town website along with a guide to town meeting procedures. If you have comments or suggestions to the guidelines after this town meeting, I would be happy to hear from you. There is a typo in the warrant. I wonder how many of you found it. It's on page 2, in the sentence at the end of the page that starts, if necessary, dot, 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 and the dates are wrong. It should read, if necessary, town meeting will resume on Monday, April 4th, not April 3rd, and continue to Tuesday, April 5th, not April 4th, if we need an additional night. This is the first annual town meeting since the charter of the town was changed to add a deputy moderator. As moderator, I appoint the deputy moderator, and you, as town meeting, get to ratify that appointment. The deputy moderator serves until the next annual town meeting. I have appointed Betsy Anderson as deputy moderator, and I will accept a motion to ratify that amendment, that motion.
Mike Rosenberg, 387 Concord Road. I move that town meeting ratify the appointment of Betsy Anderson as deputy town moderator.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no. Thank you, deputy moderator has passed. She's getting sworn in even as we speak. Ms. Anderson will be taking my place during the presentation tonight of the presentation of this town meeting, when we get to it, of Article 20, the Community Preservation Budget. Before being elected moderator, I was still serving as a member of that committee. As such, I voted on the article that is being recommended. Therefore, Deputy Moderator Anderson will preside during the presentation and the deliberation on that article. She will also be the moderator in the overflow room in the event that it is needed, and she will be assisting with the collection of votes for hand counts and secret ballots. I am grateful to her for her service. The tellers for tonight are Clive Granger, Kelly Craven, Jane Gallagher, and Eleanor Gonzalez. And we thank them very much for their service. Selectman Rosenberg, will you please read the memorial resolutions?
Whereas since the annual town meeting of 2015, employees, officers, and committee members of the town have passed away, having performed their duties faithfully, dedicating their time and skills to benefit the residents of Bedford. And whereas we gratefully recognize their public service to Bedford citizens, now therefore be it resolved that we, the people of Bedford, assemble here at annual town meeting on March 28, 2016, mourn their passing and extend sincere sympathy to the families of Catherine Alkaline, Metco Program Middle School 2003 to 2013, William P. Ambrose, Bedford High School teacher, assistant principal and coach, 1962 to 1994. Val Esbedian, Selectman 1995 to 2001, Capital Expenditure Committee 92 to 99, Finance Committee 79 to 82, Cable Television Committee 91 to 92, Zoning Board of Appeals, 1991 and 92. Ad Hoc Information Systems Advisory Committee, 95 through 98. Petitioners Advisory Committee, 2011 to 2014. Patricia Ardito, Planning Board, 1980 to 1997. Affordable Housing Committee, 87 to 92. Center School Study Committee, 1980. Central Artery Landfill Task Force, 1991. Charter Revision Committee, 89 to 91. Committee on Sign Bylaw, 1990 to 96. Registrar of Voters, 1973 to 1990 and 2002 to 2007. Electric Utility Restructuring Committee, 97 to 98 and 2006. Bicentennial Commission, 1975. Measure of Wood, Bark, and Manure, 1990. Richard Brown, Town Administrator, 1974 to 1980. Selectman, 1984 and 1985. Catherine Barberi, School Employee, 1971 to 1981, and Senior Employment Worker, 2012 to 2015. Willis Lee Davis, Fire Protection Committee, 1968 and 1969. Christopher Draskovich, Firefighter, 1968 to 2000. Mary Fodi, Kids Club Staff, 2002 to 2009. Helen A. Gelatley, Election Officer, 1982 to 1987. Esther L. Genetti, School Cafeteria Worker for many years. John Gerdes, Council on Aging, 2002 to 2014. Bernard Gallis, Bedford High School Science Teacher, Assistant Principal, Principal and Guidance Counselor, 1957 to 1993. Emily King, Library Trustee, 1981 to 1999. Planning Board, 1971, 72, and 73. James P. Harrington, Conservation Commission, 2006 to 2010. Land Acquisition Committee, 2008 to 2011. Outdoor Recreation Area Study Committee, 2012, 2013. Nancy E. Leon, Registrar at Bedford High School, 1982 to 2005. John K. Litchfield, Sr., Refuse Disposal Study Committee, 1965 to 1971. Beverly Nelson, Public Health Nurse for several years. Daniel Francis Xavier O'Reilly, School Committee, 1990 to 1999. Youth and Family Services Board, 1998 to 2000. Capital Expenditures, 92 to 2000. School and Municipal Needs Space Needs Committee 3, 1998 to 2001. The Ad Hoc Teen Center Committee, 1989 and 90. Alcohol and Drug Abuse Committee, 97 and 98. Fiscal Planning and Coordinating Committee, 1998 to 2000. John Raffa, School Custodian, 1996 to 2000. Richard Stevenson, Bedford High School math teacher, 1987 to 2009. Ruth Ann Valentine, Conservation Commission, 1997 to 2000. Wild and Scenic River Study Committee, 1995 to 1999. Evelyn Stickney, Administrative Assistant, Bedford Free Public Library, 1967 to 2004. Robert W. Willis, Personnel Board, 1986 to 1992. Town Meeting Quorum Committee, 1992. MBTA District Representative, 1992 to 1998. Fire Protection Committee, 1967 and 68. Fence Viewer, 1986 to 1988. And be it further resolved that this resolution be inscribed in the permanent record of this meeting and notification thereof sent to members of their family.
Thank you. Thank you, Selectman Rosenberg. There will be three reports under Article 1. The reports will be from the Energy Task Force, Arbor Resources, and Fond Lake Committee, in that order. There will be three additional reports that will be given before the articles that they address. One is from Finance Committee, one is from Capital Expenditures, and one is from the Community Preservation Committee. So I'd like to recognize Mark Mullins from the Energy Task Force. First, please use the front microphone. Please use the front. Sorry.
Mark Mullins, 11 Evans Ave. I'm the chair of the Energy Task Force, and today I wanted to talk about community choice aggregation. I'm going to turn around here.
No, you can see it right there.
Oh, great. Awesome. So what is community choice aggregation? It is a program that provides the ability for a community to purchase electricity at cheaper rates than individuals could get on their own. It provides better options for residents, and it was approved by town meeting in 1998. Why would we choose community choice aggregation? Well, it's an opportunity to leverage bulk buying power of the community. So rather than purchasing electricity on your own, you leverage the power of Bedford. It provides price stability, and it allows the opportunity to increase renewable energy. And there's also the potential for electric cost savings on your bill. So who's doing it? Well, it's right now 73 communities throughout Massachusetts, and that's a list right there. So what's the process? Well, the first step in the process is to approve the warrant article, which happened in 1998. So that's done. So the next step is for the town to hire a broker to help guide the town through the process. And after that, residents will have the opportunity to provide feedback, and then the selectmen will choose an option, or if they don't like the options, they can opt out. If the selectmen choose to proceed, there's an opt-out waiting period, and during that time, residents have the opportunity to opt out of the community choice aggregation. So that they don't have to change, you don't have to change at all. And after that opt-out period, residents are switched to community choice aggregation. And after, during the opt-out period, residents are allowed to opt out without any penalty or fee. So that's the process. Thank you.
Thank you for your report. Arbor Resources, Jackie Edwards, please.
Good evening. I'm Jackie Edwards, Wildwood Drive, representing the Arbor Resource Committee. Longtime residents know that as Bedford has grown and prospered, our tree-lined, canopied streets are increasingly disappearing, along with much of our woodlands. For an idea of how quickly we're losing trees, in just the last few and the next few months, hundreds of trees will be cut down for the Middlesex Turnpike Phase 3 project, which is in addition to the hundreds that were cut down a few years ago for Phase 2. Eversource cut down more than 50 roadside trees that they considered a potential hazard, with plans to cut down 2 or 3 dozen more. The town cleared a stand of about 65 trees from Shawshin Cemetery. The Job Lane School expansion we'll be voting on this ATM will cut down a minimum of 45 trees to perhaps 100 more trees, depending on the final design. The Lille Jagrun ball field that we'll be voting on also this ATM would cut down another 150 to 180 trees. Bedford also loses a large number of trees every year due to disease, age, and storm damage. This list does not include the widespread clearing done on private lots, both residential and business, or possible developments such as Springbrook Park. With fewer trees, our town loses more than the beauty and character of tree-lined canopied streets. We also lose environmental and health benefits like cleaner air and water, financial benefits like higher property values and a more vibrant business community, and safer streets through traffic calming because roadside trees tend to slow down traffic. The committee has wanted to do some replanting, but even though the town has a limited budget for new trees, it does not have the resources available to water those trees adequately for their first three critical growing seasons. And that's true even if the trees are donated. The Arbor Day trees planted in the Jenks Nature Trail in the last few drought-ridden years have mostly died or are dying off, as you'll see when trees begin to leaf out. But Bedford is an innovative town, and Bark and the DPW have developed a pilot public-private partnership we're calling the Almost Free Street Tree Project. And you may have, there's a flyer going around if you want it. The town will buy a tree and plant it in that part of a resident's front yard close to the street that belongs to the town. They'll leave you an alligator watering bag. You and your family get the pleasure and other benefits of the tree for the price of committing to watering it for its first 3 years. While the pilot project will only plant 5 trees this spring, we plan to expand the program in the future and are collecting names of interested residents for both this season and next. Our committee charter is to educate residents about the state of our urban forest. And right now, that means to the extent of the cumulative loss. We hope considering that cumulative loss may encourage some of you to help us find ways to slow the loss of public trees and to look for ways to replace some. We can't do it alone. If you like Bedford as a beautiful, healthy, safe town with tree-lined streets, it will take your vocal support. Thank you. Enjoy town meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards.
There you go.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards. If you are...
If you are in the back of the auditorium, there are seats down here on this side. They're not right on the aisle, but there are plenty of seats down here. And if you're standing when it comes time to take a vote and it's a counted vote, you won't be able to be counted if you're standing. So you do need to find a seat. The next report is from the Fond Lake Committee, Bill Simmons.
Good evening. My name is Bill Simmons. I live at 31 Sweetwater Ave, and I'm a member of the ad hoc Fond Lake Committee. So Fond Lake is Bedford's largest and most aesthetic body of water. There we go. Thank you. Thank you.
The other side is to go back.
Okay. So the Ad Hoc Fond Lake Committee was formed in the spring of 2015. Its charge or task was to review, analyze, and recommend some options and restoration methods to look at how to preserve or restore Fond Lake. The committee is made up of folks from the Conservation Commission, Selectmen, Department of Public Works, residents at large. We have a consultant on board that's been routinely hired by the DPW to look at environmental issues, and also people from a member from the Historic Preservation Committee. What are the committee objectives? One was to evaluate the value of Fawn Lake, recommend the future use of Fawn Lake, evaluate, as I said before, restoration options, recommend a conceptual restoration plan, and justify that restoration plan both aesthetically, economically, and make sure it become a recommended viable plan. One of the things we did was look at what the values of Fawn Lake is to the town of Bedford. As I said before in the first slide, it's Bedford's largest body of water. It's a major conservation asset, ecological asset, recreational asset. It has a great historical authenticity going back to when Bedford, the Bedford Springs area was a resort town in the late 1800s into the early 1900s. And it offers many educational opportunities for school-related or just family-related activities. Here's some pictures of some of the conservation aspects, great views of the lake, many flora and fauna, native wetland species, and also we have some other species, swans and geese and a blue heron, so a very diverse ecological community. It has a tremendous recreational value, fishing, canoeing, ice skating, family hikes, trail running, you know, any numerous things. I think on one day in last year on New Year's Day, I think there was over 150 people ice skating. Just happened to be no snow that New Year's Day, and we had several, almost a foot of ice. So animal diversity, we have salamanders, frogs, I've caught yellow perch there, wood ducks, also beavers, which sometimes they're helpful, sometimes they're not. Plant diversity, we have lots of native New England or Massachusetts wetland species. We do have some invasive species, which kind of is the point of the restoration of the water area. As I said before, there's vast historical significance. Here's a rendering of what the area looked like back in the late 1800s. I think the first hotel was built in 1843. That was replaced by a larger 300-room hotel in 1897. And then at the advent of the automobile, the resort kind of died off, along with a lot of other recreational areas within train distance of Boston. So what is the problem? Why are we talking about Fawn Lake? What is the issue? It's basically soft sediment accumulation. As every springtime, the lily pads and the spring vegetation grows and reaches full maturity in summer months, come fall, it dies off and it degrades and it falls to the bottom of the lake. And after being a lake, a man-made lake for 150 years, it's basically the depth of the lake has gone from 8 feet in places all the way down to 1.5 to 2 feet. The reduced lake depth and the blocking of the sunlight by the floating species of vegetation can contribute to fish kills, low oxygen conditions, impedes recreational use, tough to fish, tough to canoe, and is not as sightly as it could be. So here's a, I think I got this off of Bing from the summer of 2014, and it shows at the height of the summer and the height of the floating vegetation that nearly all of the lake is covered by floating vegetation. So you can see here from this picture, the yellow outline is what the lake should look like. And if you can make out the water, you'd be hard pressed to. So this is the crux of the issue here. It's the floating vegetation dying off, and we lose lake depth and functional use of the lake because of that. So what are some of the options that the Fawn Lake Committee looked at? Here's a long list. Basically, everything from low maintenance, cheap ways to do it on a yearly basis, aeration, herbicides, all the way up to dredging, which is more of a upfront capital expenditure, but you get a lot of a longer long-term value out of that. So what were the evaluation criteria that we used? We looked at, identified all these criteria, and we used the pairwise ranking strategy, which is a community-based decision-making process that the town and many towns use, and many communities all over the world use. And our primary one was longevity. If we're going to spend town money, it needs to last, and we're looking for something that was, would last 50 to 150 years. Here's the basic design or basic conceptual plan. We have improved the boat launch, dredge approximately 60% of the lake. We recognize it's economically infeasible to dredge the entire lake. And in the southwest portion of the area, the shallow lake habitat, there's really no point in dredging that area because that area has been identified as a limited, as a management area. So we're trying to retain the ecological value of more of a wetland area. And also, we've included the dam replacement in terms of permitting, not the actual funds to replace the dam, but at some point that dam will need replaced. And we want to combine the efforts of dredging with the dam replacement as part of the same permitting process, so it's more economical. Why dredge? Why take such an aggressive or large capital expense? Well, you get a lot of bang for your buck when you're dredging. When the lake was dug 150 years ago, we got nearly 150 years of use out of it. Over the past 10 years, the use of the lake has decreased dramatically, and every year goes by. It's not a linear relationship, it's a geometric, so another year or two, it compounds even worse. Dredging will help us support recreational usage, return the lake depth, the fish will come back, and it's basically dredging 60% of the lake is a balance between costs and benefits, while at the same time preserves shallow habitat because the area is a conservation area. So our basic recommendations are utilize some sort of wet dredging so the lake does not have to be dried out. Restore as much open water as we can. We've set the bar at 60%, it may be higher, it may be lower. As I said before, return it to its original lake depth of the mid-1800s. Respect the historical authenticity and preserve as much of the ecological diversity as possible. This plan provides a cost-effective and long-term solution to Fawn Lake's vegetation and soft sediment accumulation problem. The next steps are to vote on permitting design, a value of approximately $100,000, which will be Article 20 and Item 12 in the fiscal year 2017 budget. We request, on behalf of the Fawn Lake Committee, we request your support. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Article 2, debate rules. Mr. Rosenberg.
Mike Rosenberg, 387 Concord Road, West Bedford. I move the town to adopt the following procedure for the current annual town meeting. A speaker presenting an article or amendment to an article shall be limited to 10 minutes. B, other speakers shall be limited to 5 minutes. C, no article shall be presented after 10:45 p.m. D, town meeting by majority vote may waive A, B, or C. Second. These debate rules have been well tested over many years and help ensure that Bedford Town Meeting is a well-oiled machine. Selectmen recommend approval.
Finance Committee.
Steve Steele, 7 Jeffrey Circle. The Finance Committee recommends your approval as well.
Does anyone else wish to be heard on this? Seeing no speakers, I will take a voice vote, but it requires a two-thirds vote. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, please say no.
No.
I declare the motion passed. I'm sorry, Article 3, Consent Article, Ms. Fleischman.
Margot Fleischman, 145 Page Road for the Selectmen. I move that the town adopt Article 3 as printed in the warrant, lest the phrase pass any vote or take any action relative thereto.
It's been moved and seconded. Ms. Fleischman.
Utilization of a consent article as a means to approve routine business matters requiring town meeting authorization has been a regular practice in Bedford. Section A would authorize short-term borrowing in anticipation of revenue. Section B would appropriate funds for the fiscal 16 audit. Section C proposes that the town accept a state law provision that permits adjustment to age, gross receipts, and whole estate limits set forth in Massachusetts general laws pertaining to an existing elderly property tax exemption. Section D proposes that the town accept a state law provision that allows for increases in all property tax exemptions currently granted by the town. Section E proposes to delegate to the selectmen on behalf of the town the authority to accept any and all easements for sidewalks, trails, drainage, and other utility purposes during fiscal year 2017. The selectmen recommend approval of Article 3.
Finance Committee.
Steve Steele, 7 Jeffrey Circle. The Finance Committee recommends your approval as well.
This also requires a two-thirds vote. Are there any other speakers that wish to be identified? Seeing no hands. It requires a two-thirds vote because it includes land easements, and therefore I will try a voice vote again. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, please say no. I declare the motion passes unanimously. Article 4, Mr. Moonen.
William Moonen, 18 Crescent Avenue in the center of town. on behalf of the selectmen, I move that the town adopt Article 4 as printed in the warrant, plus the phrase pass any vote or take any action relative thereto.
It's been moved and seconded, Mr. Moonen.
Revolving funds allow income generated from various operations of the town to be dedicated to the helping to pay for those activities. These revolving funds need by state law to be reauthorized annually. The amounts in there are the same as last year with one exception. The cable committee is now proposed to be increased to $325,000. Up from $250,000 limit in order to spend $70,000 on communications, which we will vote as part of the capital article, and plus increased rent for Bedford Television at Town Hall. The selectmen recommend your approval.
Finance Committee.
Steve Steele, 7 Jeffrey Circle. These accounts allow the government to perform without having to go to town meeting for any appropriations. Finance Committee recommends your approval.
I don't see anybody who wants to be heard, so I'll take a vote on this. This requires a majority vote. Mr. Doherty, please go to microphone 2.
Rich Doherty, 49 Elm Street. Has the library gone out of business? The revenues is only about $2,000. Perhaps someone can help me understand this. Last year the revenue was 16 times that.
I think we have an answer coming momentarily.
Not being as familiar with the finances of the library as I might be, the answer is that the first $17,000 comes to the town as a local receipt. The rest of the money goes to the revolving fund, and the $1,800 you see there is just the money through the end of the year, so far the calendar year. There's more money yet to come. Does that help?
Almost.
So the first $17,000 that gets collected goes to the town. The rest goes into the revolving fund. and this only goes through January or so? That's the answer?
That's correct. So we have collected $17,000 in revenues, went someplace else. This $17,000 is the library's, or this almost $2,000 is the library's?
Yes.
Okay. That answers it, Madam Moderator.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? I'll take a voice vote on this. It requires a majority. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And those opposed, please say no. I declare the motion passed unanimously. Article 5, bills of prior year. Mr. Moonen.
Again, Bill Moonen, 18 Crescent Avenue. Given that there are no bills of prior years, Madam Moderator, I move that Article 5 be indefinitely postponed.
Second. It's been moved and seconded. Finance Committee.
Steve Steele, Finance Committee. Finance Committee recommends indefinite postponement as well.
Does anyone wish to be heard? This does require a two-thirds vote. I'll take a voice vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. I declare the motion passed unanimously. Article 6, General Bylaw Amendment, Cable Television. Mr. Moonen.
I'm still Bill Moonen. I still live at 18 Crescent Avenue. I move that the town adopt Article 6 as printed in the warrant.
It's been moved and seconded. Mr. Moonen.
The Cable Television Committee is an advisory committee. Beyond guiding the town in the process of negotiating long-term contracts with both cable operators, that is Comcast and Verizon, the Cable Committee works with Bedford TV to maximize the benefits derived from the income paid to the town by Verizon and Comcast through all of us who pay those organizations. This change in bylaw recognizes the current practices of the Cable Committee, which are similar to other committees in town, such as the Housing Partnership and the Transportation Advisory Committee. It properly states their activities, and the selectmen recommend your approval.
Finance Committee.
Paul Mortensen, 4 Wellington Way, for the Finance Committee, which recommends approval of this article.
Does anyone wish to be heard? Microphone 2, please.
Good evening. I'm Scott Council of 29 Selfridge Road. I'm a member of the Bedford Cable Television Committee. And on behalf of the committee, I would like to express our support for this bylaw change. Thank you.
Does anyone else wish to be heard? Seeing no one, I will take a voice vote on this. All those in it takes a majority vote, I'm sorry. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And those opposed, please say no. I declare the motion passed. Article 7. A general bylaw amendment, wetlands protection. Mr. Siegenthaler.
Mark Siegenthaler, 20 Anthony Road, for the selectmen. I move that the town adopt Article 7 as printed in the warrant.
It's been moved and seconded. Mr. Siegenthaler.
Madam Moderator, I would ask that you recognize Mr. Hagen and Wilson from the Conservation Commission to make the presentation for this article.
Thank you.
Steve Hagan, 2 William Street, that might be North Pine Northwest, Bedford. I'm currently the chair of the Conservation Commission. And so basically, I'll set the stage for this. We've been working for the last 3 or 4 years on process improvements, particularly all of those, any of you who appeared before the Conservation Commission said, could you do some process improvement? So what have we been doing? Let me... to the right. Ah, okay. So what have we been doing in the last few years that is to your benefit to try to make things more fair and equitable and clear for all the residents in the town of Bedford? The first thing, you know, people when they're doing activities is you have to file a request for a termination of applicability. And that end, if you're going to read, then go do something, a notice of intent. In the past, you had to show up at town hall. You had to meet a town employee. They gave you the form. They gave you the instructions. You went home. You brought it back. It wasn't right. You filled it out. You went back. Good news is both of these are now on the town website along with instructions. So you can go through this in advance before you even come up to get them reviewed. That has helped your and made your lives easier and lowered town costs because this is less burden on the town employees. A next thing is, after you do a project and get permission, it's an order of conditions it called. That means it's a list this long of requirements, things that you need to do. And it always used to be hard to say, well, why is this one different than that one? Now we have a standard list. You know, it's a long list, 1 through 19 is the state. The next 20 are ours, and then only things unique to you. So we have standard orders of conditions. There, you know, it's clear. Every resident gets the same one. Every project gets the same one. It makes it a lot simpler. The town administrator, you know, the conservation administrator, Elizabeth McDonough, writes a memo on her recommendations for what's going to appear before us, you know, at each of the meetings. But it goes out 2 days before it, so we're ready, and all the applicants get a copy too. So there's no surprises at the meeting. When you show up before a conservation commission, you know what's going to be said, you know what's expected. We're trying to make your lives easier. Now let's see if we can do it again. Oh, twice in a row. So also, at least one out of three meetings, often one out of two, cutting trees comes up. Trees within, you know, 100 feet of a wetland. You know, a tree, you know, you get a windstorm, it's leaning on your house, the tree starts to die, and, you know, meanwhile, you'd have to file for this. And then that could take 3 weeks to get permission. You got to get in front of a meeting. We said, wait, this is not working right. So we created tree policy guidelines, and what that means for you is if it's a dangerous tree, get an arborist, says it's a dangerous tree, cut it down, send us a note, okay? Take a picture too, yeah, but just send us a note, yeah, and then you can get the next one depending on how things are going. And that saves you trouble. We just get a record of it. We just want to make sure somebody's not running in broadly cross, you know, cutting without, you know, having any reason for it. But we don't want to be in your way, so that's there also. And then finally, the agendas used to be fixed time. Every 15 minutes, somebody else. Well, sometimes these agendas ran into 10 at night and 10:30 at night. And meanwhile, people said, you can't start mine before 10 at night. That's when I'm scheduled. Meanwhile, we had nothing to do if something was slow, but by law, because your neighbors might want to show up, we couldn't start the meeting, you know, on your case. Now it's just sequential. We start the meeting at 7 o'clock and we just work through everything. And we go out of our way to take who's in the room. And then we go through all the people in the room first, and then we do other process stuff. That way it's a lot easier for you. So having done all of this, we said, naively, since we had never done this before, let's work on the bylaw. Well, we've learned that that's a much bigger project, since those of you that got this handout can kind of see what we're up against, how much is in there. So what we actually decided, we could do a little bit each year, because once a year you can come before a town meeting, or we say, look, man, we're trying to help the residents of the town. We're trying to make it clearer, simpler, so you can read this stuff and understand it before you show up. Let's just go do it all at once. Okay? We may have been naive. Your vote tonight will decide that, if we are naive or not. But basically, we decided to go for it all, but that's why you've got handouts. Even us, we cut down trees. So you can see red text means it's new. Black, we just shuffled it around so it's easier to read, okay? So that's my part of the presentation. John Wilson, who did the bulk of the work, you know, is now going to explain what the bulk of the work was. I'll stand back here because, just in case you have questions, we'll both stay up here. Now that I'm trained, I can get my job. Here we go.
Good evening. I'm John Wilson, 14 Hawthorne Lane in Bedford. I was chair of the commission back in 2014 when we began our review of the existing wetlands protection bylaw. Our main concern was not with its substantive requirements. Rather, our concern was more editorial in nature, and here's what I mean by that. Our starting point was that the existing bylaw incorporated the right level of protection for the town's wetland resources. We weren't looking to change that level of protection. Certainly not to weaken it, but not necessarily to strengthen it either. We believed that it was already right where it needed to be. But we did find in looking at the bylaw, and we'd been living with it for quite a while, that the structure and organization of the bylaw, as written, made it unnecessarily difficult to read and understand, both for average citizens looking to comply with its requirements and for commissioners who have to apply and enforce it. Its organization, I don't know any other word to describe it other than to say it was chock-a-block. The sequence of its major sections was not particularly well aligned with the basic steps in the regulatory process that we're charged to follow. Our bylaw was last revised 21 years ago in 1995. And since then, in 2006, the Massachusetts Association of Conservation Commissions, known as MAC, came out with its suggested model wetlands protection bylaw. As I said, we felt that Bedford already had the right level of protection, and reviewing the MAC model basically helped confirm that judgment. But what we really liked about that model was that it had a simpler, cleaner structure, one clearer and better organized than our existing bylaw, more closely aligned with the actual stepwise process called for by the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act. We saw that we could keep virtually all the same language in our existing bylaw, but because the basic sections of the MAC model were ordered in a quite different sequence, we'd have to reorganize the structure of the Bedford bylaw, moving its existing language around so that it would fit under the appropriately renumbered section headings. So we took a format that is much clearer, we think, coming from MAC, and we moved the existing language where it belonged in that structure. Rather, we're not necessarily changing much, if anything, of the existing language. So that's what we've done. Kept almost all of our existing bylaw language, but have reordered it along the lines recommended by MAC. I hope you picked up from the back table tonight a copy of the one-page tabular summary that compares the structure of the existing and proposed new bylaws. It shows exactly where, in each case, the language from the existing one appears in the new version. The language changes that we have proposed are few in number, minor in nature, and do nothing to change the level of protection afforded our wetlands resources. Probably the most important change is one that would allow property owners under an existing order of conditions to apply to renew that order every 3 years, subject only to a check by the commission that the requirements of the order remain appropriate. Currently, the owner can request only one such 3-year extension, and then after that has to come back, file a brand new request, and go through the process all over again. We didn't see the value of that. We keep the check, but we don't necessarily force somebody every 3 years to go through the renewal process. Town council, based on their own independent review, has also suggested certain minor changes to the existing bylaw language, mainly intended to clarify current language in the light of recent developments in relevant case law, doing so in the town's interest of heading off potential litigation issues that have arisen since the mid-1990s when our law was last revised. We think the result is a bylaw that's more clear, readable, and user-friendly. That's what we were after. Before recommending its formal adoption by this town meeting, I did want to mention as well certain proposed additions to the existing bylaw language, not changes to existing wording, but additional wording. Fine distinction. There are 5 such additions called out in the italicized text at the end of Article 7 in your warrant. Each is intended to further clarify the meaning of existing bylaw provisions or to improve either the efficiency or effectiveness of our current town regulatory process. So let's take a quick look, and I promise quick, at each of them. Oh, you all did, okay, great. First, commissioners and applicants alike frequently have to scratch their heads as to why certain particularly straightforward or otherwise routine development proposals, ones unlikely in themselves to cause any significant or cumulative impacts on wetland resource areas, need to come before the commission for a hearing in the first place. While we don't try to identify specific types of such routine, quote, routine proposals in the bylaw revision itself, we plan to do so when we come to revise the commission's own regulations. The idea is to allow, wherever possible, more of these kinds of applications to be heard and decided upon directly by the conservation administrator without the need for the applicant to appear at a formal hearing before the full commission, thus saving everybody time. But there's clearly, if you're not happy with that decision, you have the right of appeal directly to the full commission. Second, the Massachusetts DEP recently provided more detail regarding specific tests to be applied to development proposals when a commission is asked to determine whether state law or its local bylaw is applicable in a particular case. That detail contained in newly issued DEP forms has now been incorporated into the proposed bylaw language itself, thereby clarifying the relevant criteria that the commission must use when reaching its individual determinations of applicability. Third, as Steve noted earlier, lack of clear bylaw language regarding the cutting of trees within a protected wetland area or its 100-foot buffer zone led to frequent, needless confusion on the part of property owners as to when and under what circumstances they could legally remove such trees. To deal with that, originally back in 2014, we developed a tree policy for the commission to use to try to clarify things for property owners. We have now proposed to actually put that language in the policy language into the bylaw. We think it simplifies the process and yet retains the protections necessary to make sure that trees are not willy-nilly cut down, particularly ones that are in protected areas. Not as quick as I thought.
It's on the screen.
Yeah, I know.
It's on the screen.
Fourth, clarification of owners' rights regarding the right of entry of commission staff or personnel on your property. Nothing has changed. The commission has a right, once they've issued notice to you, to enter your property if they are carrying out their duties. But what we've done in the bylaw is simply clarify for everybody that that right of entry is subject to all applicable provisions of the U.S. Constitution, the Massachusetts Constitution, and the relevant laws of the federal and state laws. So again, it's just clarifying what your rights are to do that. But what we wanted to do was to incent people who feel reluctant to comply with a commission order and have been notified thereof, to incent them to settle early rather than later. And so what it does is offer for the first violation, the first notice of violation, it's only $75. If you get a second notice, then it goes up to $150. And then for a third notice, or thereafter, then it's $300. We're trying to make it more flexible, usable, and in fact, incenting people to do the right thing. The Conservation Commission, speaking now for the whole commission, recommends that you adopt this article.
At this point,
we need to hear from, no, I'm sorry, Steve. We need to hear from Finance Committee, please, and from the Selectmen. So, Selectmen first.
Mark Siegenthaler, 20 Anthony Road for the Selectmen. So, as you've heard, the Conservation Commission has spent a great deal of time working on this bylaw revision. It has been on their agenda for many meetings during the summer. They've discussed it amongst themselves. They've had the ability of the public to come and make comment as they were going along and proposing various aspects of this. As they've pointed out to you, it's really an improvement of the existing bylaw. It's a little unfortunate that we had to present it in one large chunk in the warrant. Many of you are aware when we do other general bylaws, sometimes it's broken into pieces. It just didn't lend itself, in part because of the way John was describing it, there was a structure to try to fit it into. But it is significantly the same as we've had before as far as authority, but it's much better organized and should be much clearer and easier to use both for the town on our behalf and for residents and other applicants in front of the commission. The Selectmen recommend your approval.
Thank you, Mr. Siegenthaler. Finance Committee.
Paul Mortensen, 4 Wellington Way for the Finance Committee. which voted to make no recommendation on this article.
So we'll accept questions from the floor or comments.
We'll take Mr. questions, Hagen. We'll take applause, we'll take, you know.
Mr. Hagen,
oh, yes.
We don't do that. Remember? Microphone three, please.
Jackie Edwards, Wildwood Drive, and I'll give you verbal applause for organization and efficiency, and that was clearly a massive job, and thank you very much for doing it. I do have one concern, and it won't surprise you since I've been on the Tree Committee, Arbor Resources, since its inception. Really, it's a question of why you don't have the applicant send the picture in before the tree is cut down. I've been working with the DPW, for almost two decades, I think, over a decade anyway, on hazard trees and hazard tree removal. And certified arborists vary on what they consider to be a hazard. And some are a lot more generous about what they think is a hazard. So it seems to me if they send you a picture afterwards, you know, you might say, gee, you know, really, our consensus is that wasn't a hazard. And also, if they don't have to send the picture in until after the tree is removed, you know, people forget, and you just won't know that the tree came down. So would you consider either tonight or at some point changing that, tweaking the bylaw that way, so that they have to submit the picture first? Thank you.
I'm going to take the first part of that question here, and that is that we can't amend this bylaw tonight.
Okay.
So if you're going to have to vote it up or down, if you want to change the bylaw after that, there is a process that.
Okay. I would support the bylaw tonight and hope that we could work that tweak in at a later time according to the appropriate process. Would the Conservation Commission be open to that?
Of course, yes. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, that it was a subject that we've kept this bylaw for 18 months for all the reasons you're describing. And the balancing thing is how dangerous. You have a storm, it's leaning over your house. Yeah, this could go down in 3 hours. And so that's why I say, look, we got to trust the residents of the town. If they're going to cut it without sending us a picture telling us, they'll do it anyways. You know, there's nothing to stop them from just cutting the tree down.
Thank you.
We're trying to make it flexible and encourage people to go along with this, okay?
Thank you. The next speaker on microphone three.
Hi, my name is Ali Wagner. I'm 87 Concord Road. I have two questions regarding this. Even after reading this, I'm not quite clear what the definition of wetland is per se, and why would every wetland be, why would you want to pretty much preserve every wetland? A lot of it is just a breeding ground for mosquitoes and deadly diseases. So that's the part that I don't get, number one. Number two, it seems that for the landowners, whoever they are, by these wetlands, it's not fair. I don't know how you come up with this arbitrary line of 100 feet. I mean, why not 90 feet? Why not 150 feet? Where do you come up with this 100 feet line?
I think I understand your question, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Use the microphone, please.
John Wilson, 14 Hawthorne Lane. The state defines wetlands, and yet the town, in its wetlands bylaw regulations, also defines a wetland. It also defines streams. And the definition that the town has used since 1995 is there and hasn't changed. And so it's still what it is, and this bylaw doesn't change that. Now, your question is, are you unclear as to what the definition of a wetland is or if the definition of a stream is?
Well, I mean,
we kept the definitions in the wetland town bylaw, and yet we refer to them in the bylaw itself, but we don't reproduce those definitions. They haven't changed in 20 years, and we're not proposing to change them. Now,
Do you have a list of wetlands in Bedford?
So the questions need to come through the moderator, please. And I think that, yes, there are lists of what wetlands are. I would invite you to go to see the Conservation Commissioner, who is an employee of the town. She will come out and talk with you about your property and about wetlands.
That's fine. More importantly, where do you come up with this 100 feet? Is that a state law?
It is a state regulation.
Yes. Again, just to reinforce the moderator's point, the town has maps of wetlands in the town. There's always an issue as to whether they're accurate, and things may have changed. And that's usually when that's unclear, we ask for a specific new delineation. But the town has mapped all of its currently known wetlands.
Thank you, Mr. Hayes. Let it go. We have another question at microphone 4, please.
Yeah, but she's smart.
Ann Williams, 44 Springs Road. If I'm understanding what the new text is correctly, it looks as though there are new provisions now on limited projects and variances. Is that correct?
Mr. Hagan? It may mean new clarifications. I'm not quite sure what you mean by provision.
Well, it in the comparison between the old and the new proposed bylaw, the provisions on limited projects and variances are shown in red. That's all new text, right?
That's all new text.
Okay. So that means those provisions are not in the current bylaw, correct? All right.
But they are in our current bylaw regulations, and that's where they came from. It's not new language. It's been moved from the regulation.
It's been moved, so it's already in place.
Yes, exactly.
And is it also already in place that when proponents for a limited project or a variance approach the Conservation Commission, there is no public notice or hearing of those projects or decisions by the commission to grant a variance? Is that also currently the case? Because that's the way it appears now in this consolidated bylaw.
Then perhaps there's something, it's not been made clear. A variance, in 6 years, there's been one variance, request and grant. And that was very publicly notified. So if it's not stating that clearly here, then perhaps we need to meet with you and go over what's wrong and whether or not we need to clarify that.
Well, again, just to be clear.
Use the microphone, Mr. Wilson.
Pardon me, I'm sorry. John Wilson, 14 Hawthorne Lane. Our agenda is publicly published 5 days before, business days before each meeting. And every single action that we are asked to look at is advertised, and anybody who wants to come is welcome to come. Okay. So it's not like a request for a limited project status or some kind of variance, other variance, would be in any way not available to the public. They could come and comment on it or object to it.
Okay, thank you.
Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. And there's a question over here at microphone 2.
Yes, David Ezekiel, 366 Concord Road. Just a quick question on the administrative approvals. Is it always obvious what has no significant or cumulative effect? And also, is there anything analogous on ZBA or planning board or anything where somebody can essentially bypass a public process in order to get something done?
I can't comment on those. I'll give you a precise example of what we mean by an administrative approval, because this comes before us frequently. You've got a deck on the back of your house. It's been there 20 years. It's rotting. It's sitting on 6 concrete, pylons. You're gonna get rid of that deck, build a brand new one on the same 6 concrete pylons. That is no effect on the environment, unless you got a bulldozer in the backyard. People have to appear before us for this. That doesn't make sense. There's no effect, just approve it, go build your deck. That's what we're talking about. It's that level of triviality, and yet it occurs frequently. About every third meeting we get these, okay? Oh, and let me make, because finally I'm allowed to speak. To be clear, those are bylaws. The state law rules first. towns can then build a bylaw on Conservation Commission. So it's a state law, 131, et cetera. We can be more strict, or we can be clearer in what we interpret. We cannot be less strict. So there's state law wins, then the bylaw, then the regulations, then the guidelines. This was a question that had come up before. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone two.
David Powell, 3 McMahon Road. There's a lot in this bylaw rewriting that I think provides a lot of clarity, and it's well done. And I certainly appreciate the handout that was given tonight, especially with the red language that allows us to figure out what's being added. So I just wanted to focus on a couple of those red words and ask a clarification from the Conservation Commission. So in paragraph 54.5, where you have the definitions, in subparagraph F, the previous definition of that section that started driving of piles and erections used to say, or repair of buildings or structures of any kind. And the new language replaces the word repair with the word alteration. And I have a question about that. I'm going to ask my second question before you answer both. Does that mean that my house, which is entirely in a 100-foot buffer zone, that if I choose to repaint my house, I have to come before the commission for a determination? And if not, what was the point of changing the word repair to alter? And then I'll ask my second question, and you can answer both. A couple of subparagraphs below that, in subparagraph H, the previous language used to say destruction of plant life include cutting of trees, and now it says removal or destruction of plant life including cutting of trees and shrubs, which may result in environmental damage. Does that mean when I trim my hedges in my front yard that I have to come before the Conservation Commission? And I'm asking that facetiously, obviously, but I'm wondering then why the word shrubs was added to that paragraph.
John Wilson, 14 Hawthorne Lane. I certainly understand your question, and I'm going to give you an answer which may not be entirely satisfactory, but here goes. The first one, you want about F, changing the word to alteration. That came from our town council. We didn't necessarily pursue with town council the significance of that change. We took it to mean that he thought it was important, and as part of his overall review of what we were proposing, we accepted it. I don't think that's a good answer to your question, but it's the truth. The second item you mentioned, the addition of shrubs, and I'll confess I'm the one who added it because it came from the MAC model. Were I to do it over again, I would not have included shrubs. The meaning of this does not mean every time you want to trim your hedge that you've somehow got to get somebody's permission from the Conservation Commission. I would say until we do fix it in a future town meeting, that shrub better be at least 5 feet high and have an inner core that's got a diameter of at least 5 inches, which is essentially what we now define as a tree. So unless that shrub is like a tree or indistinguishable from a tree, no, you're not in any danger when you go to trim it.
So follow-up comment, Madam Moderator?
Yes, go ahead.
So I'm going to take that as an interpretation that they're not really going to apply a different standard by these words than what was applied before. I would just, my definition of the word alteration versus repair might include changing the color of a paint, for instance, and that was just my comment. Thank you.
Thank you.
We understand that, and I don't think we interpret it that way. It certainly was not the intent.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Are there additional questions?
Is it a pause time?
Yeah. I have one quick question. Is the warrant up to date and what you intend to be current law?
Yes.
Or yes.
Is
what?
Hand up to date?
No. The motion that was put on the floor is the article that is in the warrant as it is printed in the warrant.
Yeah. Typo is going to appear in other places. It's the warrant that you're voting on.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson and Mr. Hagan.
Thank you.
So this requires a majority vote. I see no other questions or comments, so I think we're ready for a vote. You are voting on the warrant, or on the article, on the bylaw, as it is printed in the warrant. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, please say no.
No.
I declare the motion passes. Article 8, Zoning Bylaw Amendment. Conversion of public school buildings, multiple residential use, Page Place. This was presented by petitioner's article, and Pam Brown is going to move the article. Attorney Brown.
Good evening. Pam Brown, 12 Sorens Way. I move that the town adopt Article 8 as printed in the warrant, lest the phrase pass any vote or take any action relative thereto.
It's been moved and seconded, Ms. Brown.
Before town meeting is an article to amend an existing bylaw, one that's been on the books for 30 years. It relates to existing school properties. For the petitioners, this could have been accomplished by simple removal of a small phrase, provided that any additional principal structure shall not be used for dwelling purposes. As I said, this bylaw has been on the books since 1985, and times have changed. We've worked with the planning board to develop a bylaw that doesn't just remove a few words and remain with an antiquated bylaw, but rather have worked to really do an overhaul that adds additional design standards, additional process requirements, as well as a special permit to permit an ultimate project. I'm going to spend a few minutes just to walk through some of the key points of this article, and then I'm going to speak to you about what to expect should this article pass. These are difficult situations in which you probably want to know more about what's going to happen at Page Place than what the text of this bylaw says. But what's actually before town meeting is a modification of a bylaw. There is no project, there's no proposal, unless this article passes. So reviewing key points in the article, this would require a special permit. A special permit from the planning board requires 4 out of 5 of the planning board members to vote yes, and they have absolute discretion to say no or to condition the approval. The purpose, as stated in the revised bylaw, is significantly bolstered. It includes to reuse former public school properties for attractive development that is compatible with the scale of the neighborhood, preserving open space and natural features, and broadening the array of housing options and cost. One of the significant things that has been under discussion in the town of Bedford in the last decade has been maintaining a diversity of housing stock, costs, and different styles and types of housing. A section has been added on performance standards. This is guidance to the planning board, the permitting authority, to give them both teeth as well as guidelines and criteria by which to review an ultimate project that gets submitted to them. It includes requiring a land use that's compatible with its surroundings. That means the neighborhood, the landscape, the adjacent uses. Looking at the location of parking and circulation, and making sure buildings and parking areas are buffered from abutters. It adds density restrictions. This is something that is not in the existing bylaw. The limit has been placed at 3 units per acre. That's actually not inconsistent with many of the neighborhoods in Bedford. Just to name a few, and I'm not really calling out anybody in particular, but I think you'll relate to the neighborhoods of Holton Street, Woodland Road, and Madawaska. Those neighborhoods have lot sizes that are generally about 7,500 square feet. Curve Street and Sunnyfield, 10 to 12,000 square feet. Clark, Putnam, and Bon Air, about 15,000 square feet. And Anthony Hamilton and Hunt neighborhood, many lots less than 10,000 square feet. So at 3 units per acre, we're allocating, and this is if you built to the full 3 units per acre, which is the maximum under the bylaw, it's the equivalent of 14,500 square feet. Access. not just vehicular circulation anymore. We care about pedestrians, we care about bicycles, we care about how people are getting transported from one place to another, whether it's for work, for recreation, or otherwise. So avoiding traffic hazards, providing opportunities for pedestrian and bicycle connections. There are open space requirements. They do exist in the existing bylaw. They're bolstered somewhat in the new bylaw. Performance standards also include details on exterior lighting. We've heard the terms sky friendly. We want to make sure we're not creating light pollution for abutting properties. Again, of significant import to this particular bylaw is a limit on the average unit size for all units. This is, so if it's a new development, it's all units. If it's an expansion, it's all of the units existing as well as proposed. So the average unit size is limited to 1,500 square feet. The current bylaw actually has a minimum 1,500 square foot average. The largest unit can be 2,200 square feet, and not more than 20% of the total units can contain 3 or 4 bedrooms. The bylaw details parking requirements as well as design considerations. Again, units that are compatible with the neighborhood, and remember this includes an existing development. New structures should be subordinate in the massing to existing, and the project would include public benefits as well as providing appropriate response to the transportation network for car, foot, and bicycle, as well as the obvious screening to abutters. So what's proposed if this bylaw passes? Really, the only property in town that this realistically can apply to is Page Place, the former Page Elementary School property that was converted to condominiums in 1985. It's the homeowners that are looking for this bylaw change. They found it to be a solution to a long-term need to add garages for their units. They currently have none. It's an aging population of many residents who have been there since the Page Place was originally developed 30 years ago. It's a way for them to bring in a few more units that will help share in the responsibilities and the cost of snow plowing and landscaping. It's the way for them to get the parking lots reconstructed. If this bylaw is approved, the Page Place owners will make an application to the planning board for 12 additional units and additional garage structures that would provide one car indoor parking for each of the existing unit owners. Just a couple of graphics to show you Page Place. This is actually a clip from the original 1984 site plan. You can see the U-shaped building is the original school building that has been redeveloped to condominiums. An aerial photo of the existing conditions plan. You can see the tennis courts over at Wedgwood. The smaller lots are surrounding single-family home lots on Page Road and Old Billricker Road. Elmbrook Road is across the street. One of the goals during our process, it was demonstrated and requested that the green space at the front of the property is something valuable to the town. The Page Place owners all agree in our development proposal, if we get to that point, we'll preserve that entire treed field at the front along Page Road. This graphic just gives you a quick overview. It doesn't look a whole lot different. Some of the existing parking areas are replaced by either garages or dwelling units. The proposal is for 2-family and 3-family structures to accommodate the 12 units. The parking gets closer to the front doors of all of the existing units. Right now, many of them are well over 70 years old, are walking quite a distance to get to their front door. What are the build-out benefits to the Page Place owners? As I said earlier, providing a parking garage to the current owners, one space per owner, not two. Restoring and improving the current property and grounds. providing a new parking lot and parking circulation with spaces closer to front doors, landscaping improvements, and maintaining the character of the existing development. It's been a goal that any new development is created in harmony with the existing units and not sort of the new and the old. Increasing the property value for all Page Place owners and ultimately additional taxes to the town, increasing condo revenues to the association by the addition of extra units to help cover ongoing expenses. So what are we voting on? Again, we're voting on the bylaw tonight, an update of the existing 30-year-old bylaw. This is not an approval of the concept plan of the project I've outlined, although we are committed to not doing more than's proposed. We accept the process with detail, buffering of abutters, listening further to some of the neighbor issues. We've met with neighbors a few times. I'm sure there are more neighbors that haven't been involved yet, but the goal is to work with them to come up with a project that Bedford, the neighbors, and the Page Place owners can be proud of. Again, the benefits of voting yes at town meeting is to create a residential use with density restrictions and unit size maximum, which will ultimately keep a smaller housing type and a lower price that we believe to be really moderate affordable for Bedford. Improved requirements for public benefits such as open space and public trail connections, stricter guidelines for permit applications, and the ability for the Page Place owners to make application for their proposed 12-unit expansion, allowing upgrade of existing property and integrated new units to share in future costs. On behalf of the owners of Page Place, we ask for your support of Article 8.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. Selectman?
Mark Siegenthaler, 20 Anthony Road for the Selectman. So the Selectman met and discussed this just before this meeting tonight. And like you, we are wrestling with, on the one hand, a project will be proposed for this site. On the other hand, the basic question in front of us is whether to change the zoning to allow any project at all, whether it were what they would propose next or not. So the Selectman discussed the improvements to the existing bylaw, which is clearly out of date and doesn't have a whole lot of performance standards that we would all want. The ability to have additional non-large single-family homes added to the housing stock as opposed to additional teardown units or other kinds of single-family home units, and the ability of the development itself to be in front of the planning board in a special permit process as opposed to a simple either you meet the bylaw or you don't. Balancing all of those things off, the Selectmen voted unanimously to recommend approval of the zoning change. This article.
Ms. Hackman, Planning Board.
Sandra Hackman, 22 Meadowbrook Road for the Planning Board. As we've heard, this petitioner's article would allow the residents of 75 Page Place, the site of a former school, to add new dwellings, partly to support the construction of covered parking spaces for existing residents. When the petitioners proposed an earlier version of this bylaw last fall, the board was generally supportive of the concept, but we felt like that the proposed new development was somewhat out of scale with the existing homes, and we voted not to support it. The petitioners withdrew the article from the special town meeting warrant in November. The revised article caps the size of the new units at 2,200 square feet, which is down very modestly from 2,400 square feet, and sets an average unit size across the whole development of 1,500 square feet, which is modest. In the concept plan, the petitioners have also reduced the number of units they are envisioning from 15 to 12. On March 2nd, the Planning Board held a public hearing on the revised bylaw and voted 4-1 to support it. The board has been impressed all along with the desire of the petitioners to continue living in, not just in Bedford, but in this particular location. The mix of seniors and younger families is a wonderful aspect of this housing, something other developments aspire to, but very often don't achieve. Reflecting the facts that Page Place was former public property, a trail linking Old Billerica Road, Route 62, with Francis Kelly Road and Springsbrook Park is a feature of this site, and also an important link in the town's pedestrian bike master plan. However, the existing deed and special permit for the site do not provide an easement for public use of this trail. The planning board can encourage the petitioners to offer such an easement during the public permit process that would occur under the revised bylaw. Reflecting both the history of the site as public property and the cluster style development, both the existing and revised bylaw also require a significant share of the property to remain as open space, 35%, more than a third. However, this open space is not now covered by a conservation easement. Again, the special permit process under the revised bylaw will provide an opportunity to obtain such an easement, as well as public access to the open space, an important amenity for both the neighborhood and the town. That's the possibility. During the recent public hearing on this petitioner's article, abutters expressed concern about the location of the new units and garages, as well as screening for their homes. The special permit process allows the planning board to balance the needs and concerns of both abutters and Page Place residents. The board also noted that approval of a special permit, as Ms. Brown said, requires 4 out of 5 supporting votes from the planning board. During the public hearing on the article, a member of the planning board, as well as the chair of the housing partnership, expressed concern that the revised bylaw does not require provision of affordable housing. However, the bylaw does mention that the board would look favorably on proposals that provide public benefits such as an affordable unit or a contribution to affordable housing funds. Board members who voted to support this proposed bylaw noted that the existing homes at Page Place provide very modestly priced marketplace housing, a rarity in Bedford. The proposed new units, while they will not be inexpensive, will likely be less costly than most new homes now being built in Bedford, partly because they will be attached rather than freestanding units. And because existing Page Place residents want to occupy the larger new units, their move will free up some of the smaller ones for seniors and others who find them desirable. Overall, the planning board feels that this petitioner's article would allow for the preservation of important but aging housing in Bedford, while opening the door to significant further public benefits. The planning board recommends approval of Article 8.
Finance Committee.
David Powell, 3 McMahon Road. Finance Committee has several concerns with Article 8. It sets a bad precedent for the future concerning targeted zoning changes lacking broad application. There's no public benefit to justify changing a prior arrangement, for example, guaranteed affordable housing. And it has the potential of increasing demand on the school system. The Finance Committee recommends disapproval of Article 8.
Other people in the audience would like to be heard? Microphone 1, please.
Meg Leshack, 8 Carlisle Road. Before I moved to Bedford 10 years ago, I became acquainted with Winterberry Way, the mixed developed housing. This is near Carlisle, next to the DPW composting area. It is a mix of townhouses and single family homes. The single family homes vary in size. I was so impressed by this commitment to sustaining a community that can have mixed economic levels of people living in it. Since I moved to Bedford, I've been somewhat disappointed that I haven't seen more like this. To me, what we're learning about as a likely proposed plan sounds quite reasonable. I agree that one doesn't want to get into specific plans for specific places very often, but given that Page Place seems to be unique and that this would only apply to that place and solves a lot of problems, I think it's worth supporting. In terms of putting a strain on the school system. I can't imagine that 12 units mixed, some of which would most likely have tenants or owners without children, would put that much of a strain on the system. So I disagree with that point. Thank you.
Microphone two.
Franco Pedisano, Myers Lane. I understand that this vote would allow a project to go forward there. And I understand that the planning board would listen to the abutters on what structures would go there. However, once it gets approved here, the abutters would not be allowed to vote on it, is my understanding, which means we could have input on it, but we would not be able to allow to vote on it. I don't think there's enough detail here to know to vote on, because we don't know what's going up there. There is currently one structure on the property. My understanding is they are looking to add three additional structures in addition to the one structure that's there. It seems rather extensive for that property, would significantly change the input of that parcel of land. So I don't see how we can vote today on allowing some project to go forward without the detail of knowing what exactly is being proposed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bonnie Ford, 8 Old Billricker Road. I'm a neighbor, but not an abutter. I've attended two planning board meetings and the informal neighborhood meeting, and I've stated my objections to the bylaw change as relates to the new residences. We have tremendous traffic problem already, strain on schools, bus routes, public safety issues, stress on town services, the wildlife displacement, the noise, ruining of the views, and loss of open space. I'd like to add one more concern, basement flooding. We've been having mercifully dry years the past few years, but every few years when the water table is elevated, many residents in our area near the Shawsheen suffer wet or flooded basements. And in 2010, it was so severe that the Bedford Fire Department issued a blast message offering pumping assistance, and they were completely overwhelmed with calls. Page Place is partially on wetlands or near wetlands, and if they start digging and installing basemented structures and erecting retaining walls, I don't think there's any way to really predict how badly this is going to affect surrounding properties. I think it's a reasonable assumption that the flooding concerns were part of the rationale behind the restrictions contained in the original bylaw. Page Place promised the neighborhood when they constructed the original units that they would not build additional homes. That promise was drafted into law. Now they want to change the law and basically break their promise. If the bylaw change could someday negatively impact other school properties as well. We really don't know that. I think we're opening Pandora's box when we start tweaking bylaws to benefit developers or people with special interests. And I think the bylaw change would be bad for Bedford, the neighborhood, and with minor exceptions, bad for the people that live there. I really hope people will vote against this amendment.
Thank you. Microphone three.
My name is Lee Vorderer. I live on Fletcher Road here in Bedford. I can't speak specifically to Page Place, but as I understand from Ms. Brown's presentation, this is a bylaw that applies beyond Page Place, and to that I'd like to speak if that's appropriate. I think Bedford has a remarkably limited opportunity for people who are not well-to-do to live here. So anything that provides greater diversity in terms of income and opportunity for housing is something I think we ought to think seriously about and positively. But I think this stops short of something that is equally missing in Bedford, and that is housing that is accessible for people who have disability. I didn't see one thing up there that spoke to wider doorways, better infrastructure and bathrooms for people who might need grab bars and so on. I'm not suggesting that units need to be built to accommodate folks who use wheelchairs, for example, but there are infrastructure opportunities that can be built in so that as you age, if you need them, you don't have to rebuild your whole apartment. My feeling is that if we're going to try to be broad thinking about an aging population, we need to think about some of us who are aging who are going to need housing opportunities that I don't think this bylaw speaks to. So I'm really disappointed, and I'm disappointed that as a community, we're not willing to look more broadly at the needs of the community of people we'd like to have here in Bedford as a diverse community. community. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Jim O'Neill, 21 Clark Road. The original purchaser made an investment decision based on the existing bylaw at the time. Now the investors want to increase the value of their investment by adding more housing to the project. This objective of theirs is not acceptable to me. It's my understanding that the new additions would be very expensive and not affordable in any way. The best decision for me is my own decision here. I have seen several hearings and many hearings in the planning board, and I don't think I've ever seen them turn down a project that was presented to them. Let the homeowners pay for their own garages and paving the driveway. If I want to repave my driveway, I pay for it. If I want to add a garage, then I pay for it. Why should I reimburse the current owners to repair and upgrade their facility? Spot zoning is not a good policy. My house was built in 1965 using a 50 or 60 year old bylaw, which stated that a bylaw that's 25 years old is out of date. Does that mean that I could rezone my property for two families? It's just not a good idea, and I'm opposed to it.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Rich Doherty, 49 Elm Street. I have a question, Madam Moderator, then perhaps a comment. Would this bylaw apply going forward to existing public school properties, meaning Davis School, Lane School, High School, Middle School, whatever the disposition of those properties will be over the next 30 years, this bylaw would apply to those properties. Is that correct?
I'm getting nods from everybody on planning board.
What is the nod? I didn't see it.
But if you would like, someone could come up here and say that.
If it's yes, it's yes. Please.
From planning board. The answer is yes. Ms. Hackman, thank you. Well, I think it's a planning board question.
Sandra Hackman, 22 Meadowbrook Road. The answer is yes, it would apply to other properties. We don't necessarily, as Mr. Siegenthaler said, we don't necessarily see that happening. Thank you.
Another question, Madam Moderator. So what buildings in town now that used to be public school buildings are available for this bylaw to be subjected to? Town center? There's the old school over on Old Billy Ricker Road? Or the red house, the red building? What towns, what properties exist now that it would be applicable to?
Who would like to answer that question, Ms. Hackman?
Once the use changes, it's no longer a school. If it's no longer a school, then it would not apply to that property. Does that answer the question?
Yes.
Great.
So then a comment.
Did you have a further comment?
Yes.
Please.
If I would, please. In 2006, the planning board conducted a survey of then people like me halfway through their seventh decade. Saying what kind of property needs to exist in this town for seniors to stay here and be able to afford living here, and most of all, have appropriate accommodations for people who are older. That is, no steps, everything on a single floor, maybe a dwelling space upstairs for visitors and so forth. The end result of that survey was 400 units then, okay? This bylaw will add 12. The another activity, the naval property, will add a few. What are we going to do? And this is to Mr. King's viewpoint. We need 400 units if we're going to have people like me now, who are halfway through my eighth decade, to be able to stay here in Bedford. What are we going to do if we don't do things like this and more too? But we shouldn't be doing it in a spot fashion. The planning board should look at, I believe, the master plan, see what the master plan has indicated about the kind of units we need for seniors to live in this town, and that is 1,000 to 1,200 square feet, single story, and it's going to take some backfilling, infilling, into existing properties. This is a start, but it's only, it's just kind of spitting in the wind. So can this bylaw be applied to all of Bedford in some way so that we could get the kind of housing we need here for seniors to be here? I suppose that is a rhetorical question.
It is a rhetorical question because we can't change the bylaw as it's printed. We'll have to vote it as it's printed. We can make it less, we can make it more restrictive, but we can't make, no? less restrictive, sorry. We can make it less restrictive. We can't make it more restrictive.
So final comment, if you would, please. How are we going to do this? Of the people in 10 years ago who were interested in staying here in Bedford, I know 12 of them have left the town, and they were great citizens.
Thank you, Mr. Doherty. Microphone 3.
Good evening. My name is Catherine Moskis. I live at 2207 Taylor Pond Lane, and I'm speaking on behalf of the Bedford Housing Partnership. At the February 25th Housing Partnership meeting, the committee voted to strongly recommend to town meeting that voters disapprove Article 8. The partnership recommends disapproval because the zoning amendment does not mandate an affordable component. While disapprove. At the February, can we hear me now?
Yeah, that's great.
Okay, we're good. At the February 25th Housing Partnership Committee meeting, the committee voted to strongly recommend at town meeting that voters disapprove Article 8. The partnership recommends disapproval because the zoning amendment does not mandate an affordable component. While the town is over the 10% required by 40B, we must make every effort to maintain our number of affordable units. Article 8's failure to mandate an affordable component sets an unacceptable precedent for future use of the bylaw and future bylaws. By staying above the 10%, the housing partnership is able to fulfill the mission of encouraging the growth and maintenance of fair and affordable housing. For the reasons just stated, the Bedford Housing Partnership recommends disapproval. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone 4.
Rob Bielski, 75 Page Road. I have to start with a question. I'm a resident, but I'm not a voter. Can I speak?
Yes, you can.
Okay. So I'm one of the residents at Page Place, and I just wanted to bring my perspective for the proposed build-out. I like Page Place. I like the fact that it's community living. I like the fact that there is a Wedgwood Sports Club right next to it, and my children could walk to it without crossing the street. And I like the location. So the only thing is we have a two-bedroom unit, and we'd like to move to a three-bedroom unit because we have two children, one boy, one girl. And so that's why, as a resident, I'm interested in this project. That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Microphone 2.
Adam Schwartz from 34 Glenridge Drive. I have a letter here from Maureen Sullivan, the Executive Director of the Bedford Chamber of Commerce. To Bedford Selectmen and town meeting members, I am unable to attend town meeting tonight, but wish to express my support for the zoning change that would affect the school property at Page Place. I grew up in Bedford, a member of the class of 1974. I raised my family here, and 4 years ago, when the kids had moved on, sold my big house on Wilson Road and purchased a smaller house in Nashua, New Hampshire. You might also know me as Executive Director of the Bedford Chamber of Commerce. My husband passed away last summer, and I continue to want to return to Bedford. I was excited to learn of the possibility of owning a condo at Page Place. For the next year, I will rent in Burlington, hoping this project will happen, but understand that first, the zoning bylaw must be amended before Page Place can make application for the proposal. I will wait as I desire new construction with two bedrooms, although I will live alone, at a reasonable, affordable price. Page Place has been and will continue to be a home for many Bedford people as they age. This existing property is in need of new landscaping, covered parking, and parking spaces closer to unit entrances. If the zoning is passed, the proposed new units will allow the property to be upgraded and for the original vitality to continue. Property values will increase, helping the town's tax base, and old-time Bedford residents will need not to move out of town. Page Place provides one of the few places in town with moderately priced market rate homes. I support the rezoning and the 12-unit project concept that I've seen. Sincerely, Maureen Sullivan.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Alex Mikhailov, Nambrosio. Couple of comments here. From the way I read the bylaw, the units that are being added are actually larger units. And the gentleman that just spoke about his interest in this project, once again, is getting a larger unit. That doesn't sound elderly housing to me. That sounds families with children to me. Families where if you're adding 12 more units of 1,500 to 2,000 feet size, that to me translates to about one extra classroom in Bedford schools. So I would like to hear from the planning board of what are their considerations in terms of school impact and services impact, and how they are working out, especially in the light of the fact that we have a article down the ballot for expansion to Lane School, and we're going to have to expand the other schools as well.
Well, the planning board is not the author of this motion, of this article, and so I think Ms. Brown, would you like to address the question?
If I make
the petitioner, this is being done by petition, so it's the petitioner who's going to need to address the question.
If I may clarify, why planning board specifically? Because they've endorsed this proposal, so I would like to hear their reasoning and how they factored that in their decision.
The question on the floor is whether or not to modify the zoning bylaw. The zoning bylaw contains the framework that the planning board works within, but specific questions like the ones that you've asked are questions that would be answered in a planning board hearing, not in a bylaw necessarily. Did you have a specific question for the planning board, or do you want to ask the petitioner who is proposing this zoning bylaw?
Well, the petitioner, as to how they're seeing that as not a development for families, and the planning board, since they endorsed it, similar question.
Okay.
Regarding the zoning bylaw as it's regulated in its restrictions, both to an average unit size of 1,500 square feet, would allow a larger unit up to 22. We're actually proposing exactly three at that size. By doing that, at that larger size, all of the units will need to be smaller, 1,400, 1,500, 1,600 square feet. The existing units at Page Place run from just under 900 square feet to over 1,800 square feet. On average, they will have to be 1,500 square feet. I've done the math on all of it to see what square footage is available. There are three homeowners that are interested in actually moving to the larger unit, and as said earlier, that would allow some of the smaller units to become available for empty nesters. Furthermore, statistics show, and I've got some nothing is an exact type of development. You can compare across the board, but I have some numbers showing two-bedroom units where the average number of children per unit is 0.14. Aside from the families that would be moving over and moving their children over to the new unit, I would expect that these 12 units might generate two additional school-age children.
Ms. Hackman, do you want to add to that from the planning board perspective? Do you have another comment, sir, or is that sufficient for your answer?
Thank you. The only comment I may have is that I believe we had several more condominium developers where we had similar projections, which did not quite pan out in terms of number of children.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Microphone two, please.
Hi, I'm Lisa Mustapich. I live at 1 Clark Road. I'm on the planning board, not speaking on behalf of the planning board. I was the dissenting vote on the planning board. I feel strongly that this bylaw is not the right choice, and there are a couple of reasons for that. First, the bylaw is excluding the affordable population, and that goes against Bedford's stated fabric. While the new units will be larger than the existing units, and the proponent is saying that the folks will be moving from the small units into the large units to open them up, these new units will be expensive. Don't kid yourself. Additionally, we are over our 10% of 40B. This number is constantly eroded by new units. By passing a bylaw that excludes the affordable demographic, we are setting a horrid precedent for future bylaw requests. For this reason, I am asking that you disapprove the article.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Jackie Edwards, Wildwood Drive, and I'm happy to say my concern has nothing to do with trees.
Thank you.
My concern is we've been talking about this development as though it's senior housing, when what we're doing here is allowing four-bedroom units, and I'm very familiar with a lot of senior housing, and very few seniors need four units. I understand it's a mixed development with different ages, but I guess it's ironic we're discussing this. When Page Place came to town meeting, we had page after page of statistics telling us how there would be no impact. We'd never need the school again because we'd have so many children per unit. And as it turned out, we have a lot more children in the schools than were predicted with each development that I've followed, and that may not be each one. We're building a new addition, well, depending on the vote. At town meeting tonight, we have modular classrooms on our schools. So there are a lot of concerns I have for this development, but the planning board supported it. So I would be more comfortable supporting it if we could modify the provision 11.6x7 B and leave out not more than 20% of the total number of units in the development shall include three or four bedrooms, to leave it no unit shall have more than three bedrooms. Can that amendment be made?
My sense is that would be more restrictive, and therefore that could not be made.
So the answer is no?
The answer is no.
Okay, then I'm not comfortable, for what it's worth, I'm not personally comfortable with four-bedroom units there. Thank you.
Microphone two.
Hi, my name is Molly Reamer, 75 Page Road. I'm a current owner at Page Place. I'm one of the three My name is Molly Reamer, 75 Page Road. I'm a current owner at Page Place. I'm one of the three current owners who's looking to move into one of the three-bedroom units, which are the largest ones that are being proposed to be built if we approve the bylaw amendment this evening. Like my neighbor said a little while ago, I have two kids. We're already in the school system. We love the community. We love where we live. We love the mixed generation at Page Place. We love having our neighbors, and we don't want to move out of our neighborhood. It's a great community. We just want a little more space to better accommodate our family. And of the 12 new units, only three will be three bedroom, and there are three current families that want to move into these larger three-bedroom units, and the rest will be smaller, and it would also make my unit that I'm currently in available to hopefully an older adult who would like to potentially downsize and stay in Bedford.
Thank you. Point of information. Ms. Brown, would you like to address that?
Yes, I would. The proposal is for only three-bedroom units. The rest would be two-bedroom units. And certainly the planning board can enforce that. I actually wouldn't object to your proposal, but we can't do that on the floor of town meeting. Just a quick statistic. Right now, the assessors are running four three-bedroom units in the existing facility. which means if you calculate the 20%, there's a maximum of 8. So there would only be the possibility of building 4 more that were 3 or 4 bedroom anyway. Our proposal is to build 3.
Microphone 1.
Peter Rickey, 10 Franklin Road. Just a couple things. I know it's hard not to get emotional when we talk about these things. We have to look at the facts, but there are a couple points here. If it is only a proposal for 3, it seems like a spot zoning thing to me anyway. But if it is a proposal for 3 bedrooms, why is the language in there for 4? And I hate to say it, Ms. Edwards said the same thing. We were told by many developers, and that is a concern, this is not going to impact anything. There's no more kids coming in. In reality, we've seen that at all the other places we've gone to Taylor Pond and everything like that. That's what one of the studies back then, a little while ago, was where these kids coming into the system. We found out there were more people going there. So you have to think about all these things. And the question I have is, if this is voted down, there is nothing to say it can't be brought back again with some corrections. I understand we can't make an amendment, the more restrictive. I don't know, I'm from East Bedford, so I don't get that. But, is that the case, that this could be brought up again? If you're fundamentally not against the idea, but there are these changes that we seem to be, you know, struggling around, can that be brought up again, this, you know, in the next or special town meeting?
Who would like to take that question?
Steve Reamer, 75 Page Place. This is not a developer-led project. This is a Page Place-led initiative. We've spent the association's money. We've voted on every step of this project for allocating money to Pam Brown to initiate this bylaw. If this is voted down, this will not be brought back to the town for vote. Second, as Pam has mentioned, 3 units, 3 bedrooms for 3 existing families that already have kids in the school district. All other units would be 2 bedroom. And I'd like to point out the one unit that was just sold, number 31, it was a senior couple, and they sold due to the distance between the parking lot and their unit, and they cannot walk, especially during winter, the 200 yards between the lot and their unit. There are other seniors above 70 with walkers, and there, if anyone's ever been there, if you have not, you should go look. It's a considerable distance between the parking lot and the units, and it is not senior accessible. And by doing this and voting this, this would make it accessible for all the seniors that currently live there and would potentially live there in the future.
Mr. Siegenthaler.
Mark Siegenthaler, 20 Anthony Road. Just to clarify the last, the previous question about whether or not this could return to a future town meeting. If it were defeated tonight, it would only be able to come back. It would not be able to come back within the next 2 years without the positive vote of the planning board to recommend it.
A follow-up, please.
Yes, that was your question.
So thank you for answering that question from that. I think we do have to be sort of objective, but we also have to carefully look at this. This is a pretty significant change. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone 4.
Stephanie Buckler, Stephen Lane Drive. First, I would say, please excuse the dress. All day of caring for sick children, but I am here because I am a concerned and active participant in Bedford, and I've heard through your different viewpoints what you are concerned about, and I am concerned that many will not take this zoning amendment seriously, and seriously considering passing it, which I support and propose because of large assumptions or things that are made, such as worrying about not complying with the American with Disabilities Act, as alluded to, or the Affordable Care Housing Act, that was also alluded to, and think a little bit of the bigger picture. Nothing in these laws have said that the changes in the building are not going to consider whether or not we should make bathrooms larger or not. Whether or not a house later will do that is not also a consideration. So I don't think that should necessarily be taken in part in your decision making. As in terms of whether or not we have fair housing, this minor change will not make a large change in who is able to come into our Bedford community. I am all for a mix of people, and I believe that this will actually allow for more people to come into our community. Those who can afford the larger housing will do so, shifting and making room for those who need more affordable housing. So I think that there's a lot of potential what ifs if we make a small change, such as what if we need more room for our schools. I would say, as a mother of two, that I would welcome Bedford needing more room for their schools for more children and to have a vibrant school system, as opposed to voting down an amendment because you're concerned that we might need more classrooms. That seems a little strange to me that we wouldn't want more. So I would take each considerable, what might seem as concerns, and really look at them individually and what really might happen, and realize that this is going to be a very small change and that it's worth considering for our fellow residents.
Thank you. Microphone three.
Rachel Field, 380 Concord Road, West Bedford. I want to point out that, as everyone can see up on the screen, what are we voting on? It is not a Page Place project. And as sympathetic as we might be, and we might all be for lots of changes in Page Place, this is a bylaw change. This will set a standard and a protocol for the future. And I think it needs to be, I think there are far more questions than answers there for us to actually approve a bylaw change, which essentially, hopefully, or purportedly, as presented, by the way, this was presented by petition from the owners of Page Place and the future developers of future development at Page Place and or who knows where else. I think before we support a bylaw change, it should be the questions raised should be considered more thoroughly. I'm not clear on why Page Place can't get a variance or a waiver from the ZBA for what they want to do, and why they are coming to town meeting to ask that we implement a bylaw change that would set this protocol for the future, indefinite future. It does bring to question, as we grow and develop as a town and future schools perhaps need to be rebuilt, this bylaw could apply to that, to those dwellings or those properties, and is that what we want? I really appreciate the discourse we've had. I think it points to the need for Bedford to really take a look at all of our zoning laws and think about how we might want to change. We've done a lot of changes, I think, for the better around industrial and mixed-use development. Clearly, there's a need to address questions of senior housing and affordable housing. This particular bylaw is not the place, and I would encourage everyone to vote no. I would like to add, though, I have a couple of other questions. One is that in this, if you're inclined to vote yes, I would like some clarification as to why there is a language change in numerous places, 4.2.8, section 1.1.1, which changes the language from property reuse, or rather from building conversion to property reuse. And I don't know what underlies that language change, but it brings up questions in my mind.
Would you like an answer to that question?
Yes.
Ms. Brown,
The bylaw change from building to property was because these are full properties. In this particular case, the existing building has already been converted, and the proposal would be for additional structures, which is the problem with the existing bylaw. A quick answer on the variance question as well. Granting a variance to allow something that's otherwise prohibited by the bylaw is a use variance and is prohibited. It's not a dimensional standard, it's a yes or no. So variance is not an option.
Thank you. Do you have a further question?
No, I don't. I just do hope people vote this down. Thank you.
Microphone two.
Dan Hurwitz, 3 Lilligren Way. Madam Moderator, I'm confused. It's been stated that this would apply only to Page Place, but what's to say that the Lane School or the Davis School or the high school, for that matter, you know, 30 years in the future, might not be converted into residential? So my question is, why is this being considered as spot zoning when it in fact could apply to other buildings?
Ms. Brown.
Hypothetically, this bylaw does apply to all other school properties. The reality is that we don't likely have any that we would make available. And more importantly, if one of those properties 30 years from now, we decided now our school population has declined dramatically and we don't need the Davis School, the town, our town fathers, many of them sitting at the front of the table or their successors, would need to determine the property to be outside of the use of the town of Bedford, and they likely would do as they have in the past, gone through an RFP process, and they would be selecting the ultimate user and the ultimate project, just as happened in 1985.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Vadim Mendersky, 9 Birchwood Drive. We keep talking about senior citizens, but why is there no explicit mention that housing has to be for age 15 up? So the new owners have to be age 15 up versus anybody.
Is that a comment or a question?
That's a question. If we care about senior citizens, why is there no restriction saying new units will be occupied by senior citizens? Like I've seen it in Waltham, they build whole communities 15 up.
Right. Ms. Brown.
The current bylaw does not restrict to senior citizens of any particular age. The nature of the development has been attractive to seniors, and it's created quite an interesting mix of people, the majority, super majority of which, I'd say over 70%, are seniors. And it's intended to continue that character.
Thank you. I still have people standing at the microphones. I think we'll take the people that are at the microphones, and then we'll see if the sentiment of the room is to vote. I'm going to do one at each microphone. Microphone one.
Thank you, Madam Moderator. Carol Amick, 18 Crescent Avenue. I'm very conflicted about this bylaw, but my big conflict has to do with the lack of an affordable housing component. And I would like to ask both the Pam Brown, representing the petitioners, and the planning board, if during all their discussions as they were developing the language for this bylaw, did the issue of affordable component come up? If so, are the proponents or the petitioners, were they opposed to it? What was the reason? Is it a cost element? I'd just like to know more about this before I make a decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Brown.
Thank you. Affordable housing was taken seriously and it was considered. It is in fact a deal killer financially. The Page Place owners will be getting their garages as part of this proposal. There is no cash being paid. And right now we're at a still infeasible even with 12 units. So we need to make sure that we can actually make the project work. We're hoping that extra amenities that are public, such as trail access and open space and things like that, will offset the affordable housing. But maybe more importantly, we want to maintain this as a moderate priced housing development. And we can't do that doing affordables because the market rate units have to subsidize the affordable units.
Thank you.
It just doesn't work here.
Thank you. Microphone two.
Bob Dorr, 2 Otis Street. Just a question of clarification. Mr. Dougherty asked recently if there were any former school properties that this would apply to, and he was told no because they were no longer in the public, they were no longer schools. So I'm kind of curious and confused how this bylaw, if it was passed and changed, could apply to a former school. Everything I read in it talks about a school. I know the summary in the back, but that's not part of the actual bylaw proposed, talks about former. But the answer was that it would not apply to former school properties, so how could it even apply to Page Place? And I was also curious as to why it says Page Place in Article 8 when we said it's not about Page Place. Is that a misprint in the warrant?
Thank you, Mr. Dorr. Ms. Brown, do you have a quick response to that question?
I think the quick answer on the Page Place was I noticed some of the articles had, for example, ZBA after it, which was just who the petitioner was, and I believe that was intent there. Reuse of public school properties for multiple residential use is the title. The text, I actually don't think, says former. Page Place is a former school property. I believe it applies to school properties that no longer need to be used for school purposes.
Thank you. Microphone 3.
Good evening. My name is Laura Bonnell, and I hope everyone in this room votes yes. I do live at 75 Page Place. I remember, not this past winter, but the winter before, we do have many citizens who are in their 70s and in their 80s. There's no way for them to have a car inside of a garage, which was the number one reason we wanted to do this. Also, many residents have to walk close to a football field to get to their cars when it's 0 degrees, when it's freezing out.
Thank you.
We do have an older population, so I certainly hope
Thank you.
That will be taken into consideration. Thank you.
Microphone 4.
Hi, this is Annalisa from 29 Fox Run Road, and I just want some clarification on something that I think I understood Ms. Brown to say when she was first doing her presentation of no more than three properties or units on an acre, and to me that sounds like a lot. We have almost an acre, and that seems perfect, so I just want to understand what she said.
I do think that is what she said. The density was 3 units per acre.
That sounds like a lot.
Thank you. The last, yes. Of course we can. You can use the front mic.
Madam Moderator, can this last speaker repeat the question?
Sure. Mr. Dorr, would you repeat the question, please? And Mr.
It was just as to applicability of this bylaw to a former school such as Page Place, even though we're not talking about Page Place relative to the bylaw.
The section 11.4.1, my name is Brandon Moss, I'm the town council. Section 11.4.1 says to reuse existing school buildings and properties. So it's my opinion that it would need to be a school building or property that is considered existing at the time of the application.
What? That doesn't make sense.
I mean,
I'm not sure where that leaves us.
The intent is for reuse. I would suggest perhaps a clarification at some point to amend 11.4.1 in terms of that word existing.
Thank you. Mr. Siegenthaler, did you want to say something? Go ahead.
Sorry, Mark Siegenthaler, 20 Anthony Road. If you could just clarify, because that implies then that Page Place is not eligible. Page Place is holding an existing special permit under the current proposed to be changed bylaw. So if their application were an amendment to their special permit, would that not apply to them?
And to continue, it also says for modification to or expansion of the prior special permit approval. And as much as a Page Place project has a special permit approval for the school property reuse, this would be encompassed within that.
Thank you. So this would be applicable to Page Place. Ms. Hosmer, you have the last question, and then we're going to call the question.
I'm Hillary Hosmer. I live at 58 Wilson Road. I have been through all the process with Page Place. I believe the issue here is really a zoning change. If you looked at the map, the houses in that neighborhood have 40,000 square feet. And Ms. Brown implied that if you added the extra units and you went down to 10,000 square feet, that was similar to other neighborhoods in Bedford. But as the lady before me said, 3 units per acre is not what this neighborhood is zoned for. I believe that the garages could be handled by the condo association. Changing the parking lot, that could be handled without town meeting. That's the condo association. The zoning issue is the question that is here before town meeting.
Thank you.
I personally, given all the confusion, advise voting no. We've had many other developers put various cluster housing projects before us. Page Hill was one example. I think we went through multiple iterations before we got through what would make the most money for the developer.
Thank you.
One more second. Tonight I've heard very clearly 3 residents at Page Place want larger houses for themselves so they can stay in the same neighborhood. I would like a bigger house for myself too, but you're not going to let me put 2 houses on my property.
Thank you. We are going to vote on this. And we are going to use those little blue cards that you got when you came in tonight, because I know I'm not going to take a voice vote on this one. So would the tellers please take their places? I also, while we're doing this, they are going to count from the front to the back. In the center, obviously, the person on this side is going to count to the yellow tape on that side. The person on this side is going to count to the yellow tape on that side. When you hold your card up, keep it up. Just because you see somebody moving past you, hold it up a little longer because they're still counting. So it's good exercise. You know, you can change arms if you get tired. So keep that card up, and also Ms. Anderson is going to count the people in the front rows. Okay, on the matter of Article 8, all those in favor, please hold your cards up and keep them up. And all those who are opposed, please hold your cards up. Is there a question on the floor? Yes, this is a two-thirds vote. The results of the voting on Article 8 are 131 yeses and 141 noes. I declare the motion fails. Mr. Rosenberg, prior to Article 9,
Madam Moderator, I'd like to invite Planning Board Member Hannigan to present the next three articles.
No, you have to make a motion to move them together.
I move that Articles 9, 10, and 11 be presented and discussed together, but be voted upon separately.
It's been moved and seconded. If you are exiting the hall, please do it quickly and be quiet so that the rest of us can continue with the business of the town. It has been moved to consider Articles 9, 10, and 11 together and vote on them separately. It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Thank you. I declare the motion passes. And Mr. Hannigan, Planning Board will be moving the article on Motion 9.
Thank you, Madam Moderator. I move that the town adopt Article 9 as printed in the warrant, lest the phrase pass any vote or take any action relative thereto.
It's been moved and seconded. Are you going to move all three of them?
Shall I move the other ones now?
Okay. Yes.
I move that the town adopt Article 10 as printed in the warrant, lest the phrase pass any vote or take any action relative thereto.
It's been moved and seconded for Article 10.
I move that the town adopt Article 11 as printed in the warrant, lest the phrase pass any vote or take any action relative thereto.
It's been moved and seconded for Article 11. Thank you. Mr. Hannigan.
Okay, good evening, everyone. I will discuss these three articles together that represent a change to the industrial base zoning of the town of Bedford. The first question is, why are we doing this? Our industrial base zoning is old. Some of it dates back to the middle of the last century. And a lot of the provisions have become obsolete during that time. And on top of that, there's some inconsistencies that exist. As we know, the economy of Bedford is very different now than it was in the 1950s and 1960s, and so is the local economy. For one thing, in Bedford, we've pretty much lost all of our undeveloped industrial land. We're now a built town, and we're entering a phase of redevelopment. Many of the current industrial sites need a refresh, they need some redevelopment and improvements, and we need to create the regulatory environment that is receptive for those needs of the aging sites to redevelop. And that's something that may interest a lot of you here that pay residential taxes. If we can improve and attract more businesses to the industrial sites, that will help to offset the burden on residential taxpayers. Those of you that have spent any time hanging around planning board members in the last couple of years will know that we talk a lot about the comprehensive plan. And why do we do that? The subtitle of the comprehensive plan is the Bedford we want. And really, it's not the Bedford that we, the planning board, wants. It's the Bedford that all of us want. We had several outreach sessions over the course of a couple of years inviting the public, and a very strong and active ad hoc committee representing a cross-section of town. So we really believe that we captured what it is that the town wants to grow to in the upcoming years. Of course, we can't specify exactly what businesses might populate certain industrial areas, but we can change the bylaws to allow over time for that vision that's presented in the comprehensive plan to unfold. The first major step in this was taken at special town meeting in the fall of 2014, where we passed the industrial mixed-use zoning. So this is the industrial base zoning. So how are we going about this? The planning department spent a couple of summers conducting studies of land use in Bedford and case studies in order to understand what exists in town. And these three articles are based directly on that work. There were additional public work sessions, discussions with the business community, and a public hearing that we had in February to inform those interested of the content of those amendments. The public hearing was attended by three members of the business community. So there wasn't a substantial amount of people at the public hearing. In a more general way, we examined certain relevant zoning standards in other towns, and I'll talk to that a little bit more in upcoming slides. We chose to break this down into three different articles. It could have actually been one article because it's all about industrial-based zoning, but just to make it a little bit easier to understand and digest, Article 9 is specifically amending the text of some of the industrial bylaws and some of the tables associated with it. Article 10 is the proposed rezoning of three parcels of land in the industrial areas. And Article 11 specifically discusses adjusting the dimensional and density requirements of the industrial zones. And I'll talk about those in more detail. So what are we doing in Article 9? In some cases, we're adding certain categories of use that weren't there in the original bylaws, such as healthcare. In some cases, we're taking definitions, such as for restaurants, that were kind of out of sync with the times in the previous iteration of the bylaw. Also, and I think very importantly, for the first time, we're establishing a general set of development guidelines for all the industrial districts. So the developers know exactly what to expect when they come and they propose something in an industrial zone. Numerous cases of these bylaws are not clear, or they actually contradict itself. And what has happened in the past is that's required a lot of extra work on behalf of our staff, and sometimes we've had to get legal involved, and it's been confusing to the developers. So we're trying to eliminate those points of inconsistency and make it very clear exactly what we're looking for in this article. And then lastly, there are some unnecessary provisions that we're removing. For example, motels now are part of the overall hotel definition. Article 10 is a rezoning of three parcels along Middlesex Turnpike in the northern part of town that you now will associate with Bedford Woods, FW Webb, and Continental Leasing. In one case, that's being rezoned, proposed from commercial, and in a couple other cases, from industrial A. The reason that we're doing that is because of a couple reasons. For one, there's already some industrial B in that area, and it creates a more logical pattern of growth up there. But also, because these particular parcels are underdeveloped, and this is a really ripe opportunity to change the industrial zoning to allow those parcels to develop more fully and really reach their potential. This is a map, and if you see in these areas specifically where the industrial B zones will be, all of it will be to the east of Route 3. For Article 11, we are proposing in the dimensional and density tables certain limited heights and floor area ratio expansions. Also an adjustment to what's more realistically on the ground. There are some things that were in law that just really aren't reflected on the ground right now. I want to make clear that this is not intended to create a lot of non-conformities. In fact, there'll be very few non-conformities because of these changes, and those that are created will have full grandfathering protection. For those of you that are interested, these are the towns that we looked at in a general matter. And I want to make clear, this wasn't a scientific study, so it's not like we went and averaged these towns and said the answer is 56.2 feet of frontage and that's what we're going to go with. It's really more of getting a sense of what's out there. Because one thing for a sanity check, and the other thing, because we do in a sense compete with these towns for businesses. When they come in and decide where to settle, they're looking at maybe Bedford, maybe some of these other towns. So you'll notice some abutting towns here, and also some other towns that may be a little bit further away that have similar types of demographics and land use patterns to Bedford. In summary, taking this step is the next major step in implementing the comprehensive plan and really helping to achieve that vision, the Bedford that we want. These articles will help to rejuvenate the business locations, hopefully attract new business and good redevelopment of the business that's there. Because of that, the Planning Board has unanimously recommended approval for Articles 9, 10, and 11. Thank you.
The Selectman.
Mike Rosenberg, 387 Concord Road. Selectman, commend the Planning Board for their vision, research, and hard work that led to these three articles. You've heard me say that 9 of the top 10 taxpayers in Bedford are located in the corridor east of Route 3. Keep in mind that one new $30 million commercial building will generate as much real estate taxes as over 50 $1 million houses. Just try to imagine how we would try to absorb that. Neighboring towns are following the same track, so we have to move fast. Selectmen, recommend your approval of 9, 10, and 11.
Thank you. Finance Committee.
David Powell, 3 McMahon Road. Articles 9, 10, and 11 provide a much needed update to the town's industrial zoning. They've been prepared by the Planning Board and staff with considerable research, outreach, and deliberation. These articles will serve to promote desirable economic development, which in turn will strengthen the town's commercial and industrial tax base with minimal impact on town resources and existing property owners. The Finance Committee recommends approval of Articles 9, 10, and 11.
Are you coming to the front? Mr. Corey.
Don Corey, 2 Page Road. I'm on the Historic Preservation Commission, Community Preservation Committee, but tonight I'm speaking as a private citizen and as a longtime planning board member a few years ago. Most of these amendments in the bylaws I have no problem with, but I am troubled by two issues in Article 9, and I must respectfully oppose Article 9. The first problem regards the proposed increases in density by increasing floor area ratios in two of the industrial zones and the huge reduction in landscaping requirements in all industrial zones. Some of those were adopted during my years on the planning board and were the subject of extensive discussion within the board then. The existing standards contribute to what I feel are very attractive properties, and we have a number of outstanding high-tech industries located in them. My concern then and now is that the industrial zones will not, they cannot, be as attractive if this degradation proposal is adopted. It just seems counter to good marketing strategy for us to, if we want to retain these companies and to attract others of similar high caliber. If we're going to increase the density, they're going to have additional acreage cleared to meet the minimum parking requirements, landscaping's cut in half, and the additional traffic added to the current congestion, I feel that it, in fact, could hurt our industrial base over the long term. There didn't seem to be a lot of input from the businesses that are located there or from the Chamber of Commerce. And I really think that that is critical before those changes are adopted. And I am troubled by the decision to put these changes into the just technical amendments. This certainly would be an absolute windfall to the developers if this article passes, but I do have major concern that it will hurt us in the long term with our industrial base. My second concern is the absence in the existing and proposed landscaping and buffer provisions of the bylaw of any protection for the Bedford's cultural and historic resources, as most recently demonstrated during the current redevelopment of the Bedford Shopping Center. Can you put that one up? The old Bedford Center Historic District extends from Hillside to Bacon. From Hillside Bacon West, and then the larger National Register District encompasses the entire 19th century town center, and it includes the narrow gauge rail trail and Veterans Memorial Park. It includes this whole area, it includes the narrow gauge railroad, and it includes Veterans Memorial Park, and the shopping center is right here. The Great Road Master Plan that Bedford had hired Vanessa Hagen-Breslin to prepare just 5 years ago stressed the importance of attractive gateways to the historic district. And until the shopping center was developed, that this area was of the Great Road was an attractive gateway. Largely through the efforts of the Chamber of Commerce, the town meeting approved putting the utility lines on Great Road Underground from Loomis to Hillside. That enhanced the appearance there and stimulated redevelopment, upgrading of a lot of those commercial properties. Now, the Veterans Memorial Park, it's right across from the shopping center, honors those who died in World War II and its subsequent conflicts. It's very attractive. And the Patriot statue is right next to it. Has added an important cultural asset. Right across the street from the Patriot statue, the former St. Michael's Chapel had stood, provided a green buffer, separating the historic district from the shopping center, and then the post office building here was attractive. It was set well back from the public way with landscaping, and you can see beyond it the buffer that the former St. Michael's Chapel site provided. Despite the Vanessa Hagen-Breslin master plan that was just completed, the approval of the shopping center plans has since changed the appearance of this historic district gateway starkly. This is a view from the edge of the historic district. This is the narrow gauge rail trail. This is the parking lot, St. Mike's parking lot, It butts right up to the bottom of the slope of the bike trailway. The next view. And from the historic district, this is a view of the former St. Michael's Chapel site, now totally a parking lot. And the next view, it's viewed along Great Road from the historic district back down the road. And the building now opposite the War Memorial that replaced the post office is just a box, devoid of any architectural character. And it's just hard up against the public way instead of being set back like the post office was. I find it quite unattractive. And as a veteran myself, I feel that it seems disrespectful to the memory of the men for whom the War Memorial was erected, and a disservice to those that put so much time and effort into creating a fitting memorial, similar to the ones that we have for our Revolutionary Civil War and World War I memorials elsewhere in town. This is not the only recent incident of this nature, and I just think it's essential that the bylaw amendment be strengthened, expanded, to require appropriate protective buffering elements be provided in all zones and all properties that abut town-owned cultural resources that are listed by the National Park Service on its National Register in order to adequately protect those resources. Thank you.
Megan.
Thank you, Madam Moderator, and thank you, Mr. Corey, for your comments. There are a couple things mentioned there. As far as landscaping, I'll have to respectfully disagree with, if you have a 50% landscaping that was in the previous industrial B, you cannot have a viable industrial lot, park it, and have circulation around it as well. And what we're trying to do is make it more realistic in order to attract businesses. As far as the Bedford Marketplace, I guess I'm a bit puzzled because we're not touching that. We certainly, there is in this new bylaw, the 671, the section landscape buffer and screening. We also talk about low impact development, pedestrian and bicycle related site improvements. But the Bedford Marketplace and the historical sites were not part of what we're touching. The Bedford Marketplace is in the limited business and the general business zones.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Microphone three.
Chris Gittins, 8 Brooksby Road. With respect to Article 10, the comment was made that some of the parcels were underdeveloped. Could someone from the Planning Board elaborate on their definition of underdeveloped and what their notion of appropriate level of development is?
The question was in relation to Article 10. The comment was made that land there is underdeveloped, I think.
Correct.
Is what the comment was. And they are asking you to identify what land is underdeveloped and
Not necessarily what land, but what constitutes underdevelopment and what the Planning Board's idea of an appropriate level of development is.
Okay.
So underdeveloped does not mean undeveloped. Undeveloped wouldn't mean open space. Underdeveloped means that we don't believe it's functioning to its potential, meaning that there's an opportunity for redevelopment and a refreshing of what's there, maybe attracting some new businesses, reducing the vacancy rate, things like that would be properly developed. And the reason that that's in the industrial B, the proposed industrial B zone that we're trying to create would help to bring in some of that type of development to help it become more fully developed.
Okay. Microphone two.
Rich Doherty, 49 Elm Street. Two questions, Madam Moderator. I recall that our revenue, tax revenue from industrial and commercial, maybe 30 years ago was 60% and residential was around 40%. That's question number one, and that's about right, I believe. And number two, what is it now? I think it's flipped to 60% residential and 40 commercial. What would we like it to be? Is that a target?
Mr. Rosenberg?
Is anybody here from the industrial community? I was going to say like 9-1. But seeing as that's not realistic, I think that certainly at very least to regain the 6-4 ratio, what's happened is, in addition to a disproportionate surge in residential development, the overall valuation of commercial industrial properties versus residential has also destabilized and no longer reflects the relative valuations that it did back in the last era. So we're not just talking about straightforward values, but also the comparable values of commercial property and residential property in the greater market, if that makes sense. But I think it would certainly be a goal to at least to regain the 6-4, even 2-1 would be wonderful.
So perhaps, Madam Moderator, this is a question of the assessors, and Mike Rosenberg made the observation that one well-developed, great place industrial would get the revenue of about 50 $1 million houses, which, you know, let's say that's about right. Does it cost us anything for that one well-developed industrial building to be there? Is it the same as 50 houses? Is it half of it? Is it a third? How does that work?
Well, it's pretty, the first answer is pretty simple. The number of children that have to be educated from the commercial industrial development is probably much less than what you'd have living in houses. A few of those people would probably live here and with children. But certainly fire protection, we have that anyway. I think, as Mr. Powell pointed out, there's no comparison. Very little cost to the town when you have new commercial industrial development to expand town services.
And then a final question, Madam Moderator. Does any of this three bylaws cover the possibility of more than three-story building? And if not, why not?
Yes, it does. So there is a limited height increase proposed in the industrial B and industrial C to a four-story building, 56 feet.
Why not seven? Madam Moderator.
Thank you. That's a rhetorical question.
Okay.
You don't have to answer that one, Mr. Hamlin.
Madam Moderator, the problem is some big companies, which we don't have, would be here in the past if we did have. Oracle, for instance.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Microphone three.
Carla Faulkner Carroll, 6th School Way. I just had a question about how these bylaws would move us toward the Bedford that's envisioned in the plan. You stated that it does, but it wasn't clear to me how it moves us in the direction of the Bedford that we've said that we want. If you could elaborate on that would be helpful.
So can you answer in terms of the long-range plan?
Yes, and thank you for the question. So there's a few things in here that will help to move to that. For one thing, the clarity is very important, because a developer wants to have certainty that when they start to investigate an area, they know exactly what is expected. And right now, there are parts of the bylaw, as I mentioned, that are inconsistent or fuzzy. So that's one thing. The second thing is the creation of that new cluster of industrial B, if we pass Article 10, has certain provisions that liberalize a bid floor area ratio, that allow for a fourth story, that will allow some, that become more developed in that particular area, which is how we envision that in the comprehensive plan, that particular area of town at the northern end of Middlesex Turnpike will have industry that will flourish and help to support the tax base of the town.
Thank you. Microphone one.
Hello, I'm Ellen Michaud, 15 Wildwood Drive, and I have a couple of questions. I want to know why we are asking for more business development when there are so many buildings that are empty and for sale or for rent. And then I want to know why, if there is any control that we have over the businesses that come here, environmental control. There was a company who polluted our water resources long ago, and we protested, but the damage was done. And so I'm particularly concerned about the impact of businesses on our environmental resources and the character of our town. Are we creating, you know, a monster? Or are we really, why can't we reuse those buildings that are not occupied now and can't the developers or the businesses, you know, make those comply with their wishes instead of building new stuff? It seems ridiculous to me.
Thank you. Mr. Hannigan, if you'd like to comment and keep it within the scope of these particular articles, these zoning bylaws, how is it going to change what she's talking about?
Thank you. So the fact that there is a vacancy ratio means, in a sense, that the businesses are voting with their feet to go someplace else. And the planning our staff did a wonderful job of talking to the businesses and figuring out why they're doing that. And that's what resulted in these type of bylaw changes, that the businesses wanted certain extra things that would attract them to town. As far as the environmental stuff, I can't answer that. I mean, we don't, all I know is that whatever businesses come to town will have to follow all the laws, certainly of the town and of the state, which would include environmental protection. But, you know, we in the planning board don't specifically address how those particular laws are written.
Would there be any policing of the, you know, any accountability?
Yes, I think your question, though, is not within the scope of the zoning bylaw that we're discussing. You're talking about enforcement of regulations in the town, and that's a totally separate question.
Yeah, I guess it is. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Microphone two.
Lucille Wilson of Hancock Street. I have a question about the hotel. I was wondering about the Bedford Plaza and how the residents in the Bedford Plaza who are poor are covered or not, and how we protect those poor people.
Is there any change to the hotel situation the way it is now and by this bylaw? Are you changing something within the hotels that exist today?
So the new bylaw does cause, actually the old bylaw also called for a limitation on the amount of time someone could occupy a hotel as a residence. And the reason for that really is just to make sure that it's really a hotel and not a residence. We do have, a person's allowed to occupy, guests may occupy rooms not more than 4 continuous months. And there could be cooking facilities. In addition to that, we allow for certain business activities by a special permit. So if a residence inn or such were to come to us, that would be something that we consider in the special permitting process. I certainly respect and understand what you're saying about the poor. That the Bedford Plaza situation was a state program. So the state chose to put it in that particular hotel, and we don't really address that in this bylaw.
Oh, thank you.
Microphone three.
Jerry Pfeffer, 28 Battlefield Road. Time was the height restrictions on buildings was somewhat related to the ability of the fire department to fight fires in those buildings. And we're going from a 45-foot height to a 56-foot height, which is 11 extra feet. And I have a question to the selectmen. Is there any concern about our infrastructure with the fire department and its ability to combat fires should they occur in these places?
That's a good question, Jerry. I'm glad you brought it up. I'm looking at the fire chief, and he is indicating that we're good.
Microphone one.
Thank you. Ron Cortes, 3 Jeffrey Circle. Madam Moderator, I guess I have to call you Madam Moderator now.
Yes, you do.
I'm a member of the Bedford Board of Assessors, and there were a couple of questions, including one Ms. Micio had, that I'd like to address. We talk to property owners, whether they're residential or industrial. I've had, since I've been on the board, a specific interest in trying to reverse this 60-40, 40-60 switch in where our taxes come from that Mr. Daugherty brought up. We have a number of buildings over on the other side of Route 3 that are very old and very tired and very empty. And because of state requirements in how we assess the values of those buildings, their value has, for taxation purposes, has come way down. We've talked to some of the owners about, well, why don't you renovate your building? You attract more people, you could fill the building up, and of course your taxes would go up. The answer we get is companies' needs have changed. A lot of those old buildings have 9-foot ceilings on each floor. 9-foot ceilings, you cannot put the amount of infrastructure, whether it's networking or whatever, in there. They need to raise not so much the height, but they need to raise the height of a floor. So when they go to rebuild the building, they want to be able to build a 3-story building with 12-foot ceilings rather than a 4-story building with 9-foot ceilings, which nobody in their right mind would ever do these days. So these requirements that are in this, I cannot speak for the Board of Assessors because we have not formally taken a position on this article, but speaking just as one of the 3 assessors, I guarantee you I would vote to support this article. I think it's exactly what we need for helping to refurbish our empty industrial space. A couple of years ago, we had 500,000 square feet of empty space over there. That's gone down, but it needs to go down further. So I urge you to support 9, 10, and 11. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone 2.
Adam Schwartz from 34 Glenridge Drive. I'm representing the Bedford Chamber of Commerce. The chambers work closely with planning board, other people, more importantly, been involved with businesses getting feedback on why these changes are needed. And I think a lot of what was just said there is very true. A lot of these buildings are very old. The amenities are not there. People want more modern buildings. They want to have cafeterias. They want outside places. They want walking paths. And we think that the changes in this zoning law will get these buildings occupied, get more businesses in town, get vitality, and more importantly, get those values of those buildings up. Those values of those buildings, as people have said, just one or two buildings can be worth a lot of money. And one of the things we really want to do is get those buildings occupied and help offset the residential tax rate. So the chamber is in support of Articles 9, 10, and 11. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone 4.
Stephen Dangle, 59 Notre Dame. I'd just like to point out that it's very convenient to work in Bedford if you live in Bedford, which I've done for over 30 years, other times commuting to Technology Park just over the line of Bill Ricker because they had industrial zoning laws that made it very convenient for the developer to develop. So I recommend that anything we can do to improve the industrial buildings in Bedford is good for Bedford residents and for future Bedford residents.
Thank you.
I support the measure. Thank you.
Microphone 1.
Peter Rickey, 10 Franklin Road. Change can be good, and I think there's a lot of good things said about this, but I did like Mr. Corey's point that we do have to read into these things and be careful. One of my favorite sayings is, those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it, and I think he was kind of pointing that out with the Bedford Marketplace, even though this is not what's going on there, but there is a concern when you read into that 9 about the buffer zone and everything. I appreciate all the planning board's done, don't get me wrong, but there is some concern here, and I think that's what some of these people are voicing, that we want the right mix. We want industrial, but we want to still retain our image and what we have. And when people follow that rule, and they might be within the rules they are following, but it doesn't necessarily come out with what the community wants. So that's the real key to thinking about this. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone 4.
Robert Calantari, 8 Donovan Drive. Just for clarity, I am a Zoning Board of Appeal member, but this comment is making this comment on my own. I do agree that we do have antiquated bylaws that need to be changes, so I do support the changes that are proposed. But it seems like the focus is if we change these bylaws, we're going to have more business in town and they're going to bring more taxes. And the question was asked, you know, why the taxes shifted from, you know, business to residence and whatnot. And my assessment that I've shared with our selectmen here is the tax assessment that we have done for businesses needs major overhaul and review. I've brought up I've looked at number of properties in town that they are assessed way below the market value. VW dealer assessed at $1.1 million, Sullivan Tire at $650. Again, I'm speaking from my memory, I don't have my notes. Some of the gas stations in town are assessed at $230,000. I mean, VW dealer assessed at $1.1 million, I'll buy it today for $5 million. The Bedford Plaza is assessed at $1.8 million. We have homes at $1.5 million. Bedford Plaza with 120 rooms assessed at $1.8 million. And we know they had number of, you know, children there, students, went to school and all that, separate subject. So it's great to have businesses in town as long as they are paying their share of taxes. And my assessment, and again, I shared this with the selectmen a couple of months ago when I attended a meeting, I listed at least 10, 15 random properties on Great Road, including some of the new development, that when you look at the assessment, they are way, way below market value, and has nothing to do because they are not occupied. I think they haven't been looked at properly, and they are not assessed correctly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You have something new to add, Mr. Hennigan?
To a previous question.
Go ahead.
Just quickly, a couple of people have mentioned concerns about particular zoning at the marketplace, and I just want to point out that Article 15 is going to propose a consultant to look at the entire Great Road zoning to help alleviate some of those concerns.
Thank you, but I think the point that he was making was that he was showing those because he was saying that you've changed the requirements for vegetation in the zoning. We're ready to vote, I think. We will vote on each one of these individually. Mr. Hennigan, would you take your seat, please? Thanks. We're going to vote on each one of these individually. They do take a 2/3 vote. I think I'm going to have, well, I guess we'll try a voice vote on Article 9. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, please say no. I declare the motion passes. Article 10. Also requires a 2/3 vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, please say no.
No.
I declare that article passes. And Article 11. Also requires a 2/3 vote. I'll take a voice vote. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And those opposed, please say no.
No.
I declare that article passes. Mr. Rosenberg.
Madam Moderator, I move that town meeting adjourn and reconvene reconvene tomorrow, March 29th at 7:30 in this room.
It's been moved and seconded that we adjourn to tomorrow night at 7:30. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Thank you. We are adjourned.